Ever wonder why someone would wake up at the crack of dawn just for a chance at the unknown? Maybe a better question is, what are you waiting for? Pacifico is brewed for those who follow their own path. That's living life anchors up.
Control?
Day trips are better than daydreams. Experience the thrill of a bigger world in a Lexus high-performance vehicle. Visit your local Lexus dealer in person or online for exceptional offers at the Golden Opportunity Sales Event. Experience amazing at your Lexus dealer.
Fall on a Saturday night after the most tumultuous offseason of the sport's history, two FCS powers led by talented rosters kick off the 2020 season in Montgomery, Alabama, 11th-ranked Central Arkansas, taking on 13th-ranked Austin Peay as we welcome you to the 2020 Guardian Credit Union FCS kickoff on ESPN, presented by Geico. Here's what we know about college football as of August 29th. Six FBS conferences plan to play this season. Four of them have postponed, most notably the Big Ten and the Pac-12 out of the Power Five, and 15 of the 126 FCS programs plan to play. And with that, it is my honor to officially welcome you to the start of the 2020 college football season. Alongside Mike Golic Jr., I am Matt Berry. Third member of our team, Lawrence Sisler, is going to join us in a minute. But Mike, for the last 5 months, we've had a few questions. Will they? Won't they? How will they? And tonight we get to answer them.
We get that answer because here we are now. Matt, I played a lot of night games. None of them feel quite as momentum as this one.
We've been waiting, and we know for one certain thing, it's going to look unlike anything we've ever seen in college football history because of the COVID-19 pandemic. These are some of the protocols these teams will be dealing with throughout the season. Daily health screenings, most notably weekly testing. Both of these programs tested on Wednesday before they got on their buses to make the trip to Montgomery, Alabama. So it's going to be a work in progress for every program this country. It's going to be a work in progress, including for us. We can tell you tonight, 2,000 fans will be in attendance at the stadium, socially distanced. We are going to be doing our broadcast from here in our studio in Bristol, Connecticut, but it doesn't mean it's not going to be fun talking ball for 4 hours. But Mike is a former college football player. This just adds another layer of responsibility to these players.
The minute you step on any college football campus, you are worn out by the words accountability and discipline. They're everywhere, plastered all over every part of your building. That took on a whole new meaning this summer. The COVID measures in place to help protect these athletes are something they had to adhere to, and they held each other accountable for, and they stayed disciplined to. And so now they get the payoff for all that work this summer. And a lot of that work is included drilling every possible scenario and situation in this. Who will be on the field? Who won't be on the field? Coaches, players. And tonight, we don't know if it is COVID-related, but we do know that Austin Peay is going to have to respond early to not having one of their best players in the lineup.
Yeah, their preseason offensive player of the year, D'Angelo Wilson, their star receiver, did not make the trip to Montgomery, Alabama. He will not play for the Governors tonight. Now, one of the big things everybody's going to be watching for, Mike Golic, it's going to look like football. It's going to sound like football. But what will the sidelines, what will everything encompass during tonight's game? For more on that, we send it to the third member of our team, and Lauren Sisler. Lauren, good evening.
Matt, there are a multitude of protocols here on the sidelines tonight to ensure the health and safety of everyone that is on this field. Most notably, you will see that every coach and every player will be wearing a mask and or a gaiter when not on the field of play. You will also see that the sidelines have been extended in the team area now to the 15-yard line. Plastic cups will also be used as opposed to water bottles to ensure they are disposed of after each use. And I'll tell you guys, after talking to the coaches and quarterbacks from each team this week, they are bought in, willing to follow every protocol and do whatever it takes to play the sport that they love. And tonight, they want to set a precedent for all of college football.
Lauren, that is perfectly said. Jeremiah Oldsfall, quarterback for Austin Peay, that's what he had to say about it. We want to set the tone for college football. As for Braylon Smith, look at this. Star quarterback, Central Arkansas. He said, we know it's at stake. We're trusted to do the right thing. Sit tight, buckle up. College football returns after the break.
The Guardian Credit Union FCS Kickoff, presented on ESPN by GEICO, is brought to you by Arby's. Arby's, we have the meats. And Boost Mobile's all-new Shrink It plan, a brand new way to mobile. Visit BoostMobile.com for more.
Ever wonder why someone would wake up at the crack of dawn just for a chance at the unknown? Maybe a better question is, what are you waiting for? Pacifico is brewed for those who follow their own path. That's living life anchors up.
Control?
Day trips are better than daydreams. Experience the thrill of a bigger world in a Lexus high-performance vehicle. Visit your local Lexus dealer in person or online for exceptional offers at the Golden Opportunity Sales Event. Experience amazing at your Lexus dealer.
Austin Peay, Central Arkansas, getting set to kick off the 2020 college football season. Here on ESPN, Mike Golic Jr., Matt Barry, Lauren Sisler alongside. It will be a fun evening here in Montgomery, Alabama. I am not a weatherman, but I can tell you it's football weather. 81 degrees, partly cloudy, not much wind to speak of, which means we are getting set to play a little football. Central Arkansas has won the toss. They will defer. Austin Peay will get the ball first. And throughout the past couple of weeks, social unity has been a topic, and that is Central Arkansas. They said before the game, a demonstration of social unity at the opening kickoff will be all of them raising their fists for the opening kickoff of tonight's season. And the 2020 season is underway. Kick goes into the end zone. That's where we'll see Austin Peay's offense take over the 25-yard line. And that conversation stops and starts with their quarterback, Jeremiah Oatesball.
Jeremiah Oatesball, who was injured in this very game last year and is chomping at the bit to get back on the field. This guy is a leader in every sense of the word, a great signal caller, a great family behind him. He is someone so grounded in his faith, took seven teammates on a mission trip to Uganda, and has now come back after that injury. I think as charged as anyone. We know this offseason has been a difficult one for all athletes to weather, but especially coming off losing last season, I think he's especially primed for a hell of a comeback this
year. And we'll get to know Oatesball throughout the evening, his remarkable story about his family. But again, injured in this game last year, eighth play, week two. He looks to return Austin Peay to their 11-win glory from a year ago. C.J. Evans in the backfield. He's the true freshman. And right away, Oatesball is going to keep it. Pitch it to Evans. Evans, a nice block outside. And Evans has room. C.J. Evans makes a guy miss. And you wanted college football. First play, touchdown, Governors. 75 yards. And Mike Golic Jr., how about that to kick off the 2020 season?
Matt, it feels like we've been preparing for this game for a month leading up to this, and we could have prepared for every situation. What if I told you Austin Peay would kickstart your season with a little full house backfield, speed option to the edge for a 70-plus yard touchdown? Is that something you might be interested in?
You know what? If I was scripting this, I wouldn't have scripted it any better for that for Austin Peay. C.J. Evans, the true freshman, the quarterback back, Jeremiah Oatesball in the first play of the game of the 2020 season. I hope that that's indicative of what we're about to see not only tonight, but every Saturday now until the end of the year. Grant Paulette on the kick. It is good. And 16 seconds into the game,
We have 7-0 Golic Jr. What a play here to begin.
Incredible stuff, and we asked Tim Zetz, their offensive coordinator, would there be any hesitance to run Jeremiah Oatfall, considering he was injured on a design QB run? You see the cutback in the open field by C.J. Evans here, and let's get a shot of the big boys up front going to work on this. You see the cuts, the misdirection there, creating some hesitance by the linebackers. That pulling guard gets someone to sit there just long enough, a little too flat-footed, and all of a sudden, C.J. Evans, how about the true freshman out the gate, his first play in college football?
A true freshman, and we know the running backs were going to be a story for Austin Peay tonight. C.J., we said, a true freshman, Brian Sneed, the transfer from Ohio State, he figures to add to the running game. But my guess, if Evans Jr. is going to start his career with run rush, 75 yards, Crystal, he might be in there for quite some time. What a way to get this thing started.
The only true freshman on the offensive or defensive two deep for Austin Peay. That's a way to earn trust early on in this. And the adrenaline, managing that early on in this game was always going to be a challenge in any opening game, let alone the first one kicking off college football. That's how you get it done.
So Grant Paulette set to kick. Cameron Myers and Christian Richmond deep to receive for the Bears. They return this kick, Golic Jr. I'm just going to take my headset off. And it's going to be returned by Myers. And he'll be brought down by a host of governors. Well, they'll take over. Braylon Smith and the Bears at the 20-yard line. An experienced quarterback and a great player to lead this offense.
A great player. And listen, this team knows a thing or two in UCA about great quarterbacks. How about a record setter last season? The single-season leader in yards and tied in touchdowns. And does a little roping and riding in the meantime on this one. His offensive coordinator ranted and raved about his ability with a lasso and even more about his ability on the field. This is a top-notch leader and a guy who throws a hell of a deep ball.
He was big in this game a year ago, 283 yards and 3 touchdowns. He has a set of receivers, Lawan Winningham and Tyler Hudson, both worth watching tonight. Both talented players in their own right. So first down and 10 for the Bears. The give to Kier Crossley, their tailback, and he takes it outside for a gain of 4. Tackled by Isaiah Norman.
You're going into that first drive of the season, Matt. You're thinking about the little things here. Ball security, especially coming off an abbreviated offseason, making sure every exchange like the one we just saw there is clean.
Now second and 4, Smith to throw, throws it outside to Winningham. Winningham, one of their talented receivers, makes a couple of men miss, moves the chains, and a first down for Central Arkansas. Got a flag on the play.
Roughing the passer, number 90 of the defense. It's a 15-yard foul, automatic first down.
That penalty on Damian Barber. Take another look, Golic Jr.
And well after he releases the ball, just no excuse for that. Even early with all that adrenaline, you got to understand that's 2 or 3 seconds after he lets go of that ball. That's an easy 15 yards after your team gained momentum early.
I do want to get to some of the protocols with the officials. They will be wearing masks during the play. They will drop them if socially distanced afterwards. And they are using electronic whistles. We'll get into that throughout the evening. And Smith again, another quick hit of that ball, skipped and falls incomplete, intended for Dwight Blakey.
You look early on, the game plan seems to be try and get some easy completions laterally for Braylon Smith. And with a defense that loves to get downhill and attack as much as Austin Peay does, getting the ball into your hands of your playmakers and trying to break through that first wave is huge.
I've got an earpiece inside this ear.
So now second and 10. Just into Governor's territory. Smith again to throw, goes deep, lots of contact intended for Winningham.
Lots of pushing and seven from Isaiah Norman on that one. This was a matchup that they took personally, losing this game last year on 2 late deep passes to guys like Winningham and Tyler Hudson. This defensive secondary has a lot of pride about it that comes from their coach.
Pass interference. Number eight of the defense. That's a spot foul and an automatic first down.
That number eight on Isaiah
Norman. One play due to helmet coming off.
Left side of the screen, and Braylon saw this right at the beginning, isolated one-on-one. Anytime you see Hudson or Winningham one-on-one on the outside, you know Braylon's letting it fly that way. They call him 50-50 balls. It's more like 60-40 with these guys.
So two big penalties for the Governor's defense. Again, keeps the drive alive for Central Arkansas. And again, Smith looks to throw, rolls out, throws right, has a man, drops, incomplete. That again, Blakey, the intended receiver.
And getting Braylon Smith on the move going to be a big part of tonight again with the pressure coming from that defense. And you can't make him much more open than that. When you're sitting in the offensive meetings, that's exactly how you draw it up. So now, as we get into this and you look at these second and long, potentially getting into third and long situations, down closer to the high red zone here. Watch for more of those one-on-one balls to guys like Winningham.
Ken Collins, the offensive coordinator, says that he loves that Braylon Smith, with all the experience and what he's been able to do with this offense for the last couple of years. Second and 10 now, Smith gonna go up top again. Tries to find Winningham covered by Isaiah Norman. That is a matchup already. We've seen the first few plays this series.
And it is going to be a fiery one. We talked to Dominic Bowman, their defensive secondaries coach, co-defensive coordinator, and he said, we're not changing for everybody. We know they've got great receivers, but we're going to get up, we're going to be a press man team and be physical the way we've already seen from Isaiah Norman in a couple of instances.
So third down now for the Bears offense. Smith steps up in the pocket, flips it ahead to Crossley, and he's met by a host of Governors to bring up fourth down. Led by their talented linebacker, Jack McDonald. Early decision here for Nathan Brown.
Early decision, I like the aggressive play. You come out firing right now. You saw the tone set on the other side here, and you know you've got two receivers on the outside that can win. You're going to get that two high shell and potentially room to move underneath if Braylon wants to take off for that first down.
So Central Arkansas going to go forward on fourth down, their first offensive possession of the game. Smith again forced to step out of the pocket. That incomplete. And Austin Peay's defense holds Braylon Smith's Central Arkansas offense, and they will take over. Did you miss college football? The answer is yes. We're back after this. Austin Peay up 7-0 early.
Ever wonder why someone would wake up at the crack of dawn just for a chance at the unknown? Maybe a better question is, what are you waiting for? Pacifico is brewed for those who follow their own path. That's living life anchors up.
Quantro?
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 Natural disasters are a fact of life in the U.S. And between activities and school, chances are you won't be with your kids when they happen. Will they know what to do? Ready.gov/kids can help your children feel prepared, not scared. So talk with your family today.
The Guardian Credit Union FCS Kickoff is presented on ESPN by GEICO. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. And in part by the City of Montgomery, Montgomery, Alabama. The capital of dreams.
Throughout the evening, we will celebrate FCS football, which has turned out so many talented players, including some of those Hall of Famers we just showed you. Walter Payton, Phil Sims, the great Jerry Rice, and Charles Haley. But first things first, second possession for Oatesfall, and the Governors scored on their first play, first possession. And there for the first time, we see Ohio State transfer Brian Sneed
for 3 yards. And Bryant Snead, a five-star recruit coming out of Ohio State, he was dismissed from the team for an alleged sexual assault investigation, spent a year at a junior college, but we know this coaching staff is excited to have Snead a part of their offensive team this year. Now second and seven, Oatesfall to throw, looks right, comes back, he's got the ability to run, and Oatesfall knocked out of bounds, not before getting a great block to spring him outside. A first down for the Governors. Golic Jr. taking a look at some of their impact players.
Absolutely. We talked about it. D'Angelo Williams not in the lineup for them, their best receiver from last year. But Benico Harley, an equally deadly guy in his own right, a former quarterback, now starring as one of their great wideouts. Jeremiah Oatesfall, we know and love. And how about the defense for Central? J.W. Jones, some NFL pedigree in that family. And Robert Rochelle, there's a pair of great corners in this game on both sides. He's lining up in purple for Central Arkansas.
The offensive coordinator Tim Zatz told us of Benico Harley. Reminds him a lot of Anquan Boldin. Wants to get him the ball early and often tonight. Again, it's Snead off the right side for a physical run. Gain of 4 for Snead.
And you're seeing this full house backfield option looks right now, taking advantage of the personnel loss there and turning it into a positive, saying, all right, we know Brian Snead, incredible talent. You're seeing Jay Parker lined up in that backfield, an incredible move player for them, a guy with plenty of juice to those feet. They're going to use him in a lot of different facets on this offense.
And already you see the difference between Snead and C.J. Evans and their running ability. Snead, you can tell, just packs a punch when he runs the ball, a fake to Snead. This time to Harley, he's going to throw. Incomplete. And you had mentioned it, Harley, a former quarterback, they know that they've got that play available intended for Eugene Minter, the tight end.
We were looking at this one early, and you see all of the options set off that backfield formation. The southpaw there, taking a look at it. Great job by Central Arkansas getting upfield and getting pressure, making him just uncomfortable enough to have to throw off balance for a receiver that had a chance.
Jordan Pollard also in the area of that. So now 3rd and 6, ball just shy of the 50-yard line. Oatesfall, ball out quick, ball falls incomplete. That intended for Garrell Sumore. And the Bears defense, a nice job. 4th and 6.
Picked up across the board, tries to make a tight throw, and just a great play on the ball by DeAndre Lamont on the other side.
So we saw the Bears go for it when they had it 4th and 7. Austin Peay elects to punt. Cole Deeds set to punt for the Governors. Recovers it. And a costly error for the Governor's special teams as Central Arkansas is going to have a great opportunity and great field possession.
Week one coming off a limited offseason. We know one of the most important points is going to be clean exchanges, both quarterback and center, and in this case, your long snapper and punter getting it off after a fumbled exchange. Back after this.
Ever wonder why someone would wake up at the crack of dawn just for a chance at the unknown? Maybe a better question is, what are you waiting for? Pacifico is brewed for those who follow their own path. That's living life anchors up.
Quantro?
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 With Julia's autism, loud sounds can be too much.
But she still loves to make music.
Yeah.
Play band.
Early screening for autism can make a lifetime of difference. Find out more at screenforautism.org.
To me, football means coming together to achieve a common goal with the same guys that you're going to make lifelong memories with.
Passion, dedication, family, and friendship.
College football represents opportunity.
I wouldn't be able to be where I am today or have met the people that I've met if it wasn't for football.
With all due respect to the stars of this sport, the other 98% that may not make it to the NFL, Saturdays for them mean everything. And you just heard what college football means to several of the Central Arkansas Bears who were just happy to be suited up prime time on ESPN. Second possession for Braylon Smith in the Bears offense. That's Kiere Crosley off the left side and a nice gain on first down. Gain of six for Crosley. Taking a look now at the impact players for the Bears.
We know it starts with the quarterbacks on both sides. Braylon Smith, we mentioned those great deep passes to guys like Luan Winningham. And then the other side, Cordell Jackson. We talked about the other great defensive back. You're going to see him firing from all parts of the field. They want to get him involved in the blitz coverage in every aspect of this game.
Worked on first down. Ride Crosley again on second down. Looks to be just short of the first down and a gain of three.
And you're going to see Central Arkansas work in and out of spread formations, some pro sets. They've got a variety of in their arsenal on offense.
Third and short. Crosley again tried to bounce outside, and a great effort by Austin Peay's defense, tackled by Terrell Vassell.
Terrell Vassell came over from Villanova, a two-year player for them, firing and filling downhill. A great job on that run fit. Getting penetration is what this Austin Peay defense lives for. They want to knife up field, try and get you to move laterally like they did on that last run, and then all hats to the ball. Think Seattle Seahawks and that swarm defense.
Second consecutive possession. Central Arkansas is going to go for it on fourth down. Smith to throw. Forced out of the pocket, throws on the run, incomplete. Intended for Gerard Barnes. And another stop, and there's the first look we get at the star, Cordell Jackson, for Austin Peay, Governor's Hold.
And you see the pressure forcing Braylon out to the right from Terrell Lucas in that defensive end spot. And then you get 13 closing. Cordell Jackson, he might only be 5'9", but he is shot out of a cannon everywhere he goes on this field.
He is a player that from the time he stepped on this campus has played with a chip on his shoulder, come from Birmingham, Alabama.
Coach Bowman, their DB's coach, said, me and you got one thing in common. Alabama didn't want either of us, and he plays with that chip.
They play the entire time with that. So here comes Oldsfall into Governor's offense. Again, a pitch outside to Evans. It's no 75-yard touchdown run on your first run, but it'll do for two for the Governors.
I'm never not going to be 300 pounds at heart, and so seeing the receivers they've got in the backfield sets coming across the line, getting involved in the blocking schemes, and we've seen them lay some pretty big hits already, that warms my very meaty heart.
What's your playing weight right now? What are you at?
We're a solid 260 post-quarantine, which feels like an act of God.
I mean, you like tweeting about eating a tub of ice cream every day, so I was just curious.
The brand is strong, Matt.
Second and eight. Play clock down to five. Oldsfall gets the snap off. Back to throw. Quick release. Over the middle. Caught by Eugene Minter. And he's able to move the ball.
You see the loss in here again. D'Angelo Wilson, their best player, the preseason offensive player of the year, not making the trip for them. Over 1,500 yards last year, and a guy who, outside of just the production, draws attention. He opens it up for guys like Benico Harley to get easier one-on-one looks, and so now you're going to have to figure out ways to manufacture a little more for the rest of the group.
These two, Wilson along with Harley, regarded as the two best receivers, perhaps, in all of FCS. Wilson not making the trip for Austin Peay. Certainly a big blow to this offense early on in their first-year head coach, Marcus Lovings. Now third and two. And right up the middle for Brian Sneed. And he's going to be short of the first down, fourth and short.
Just a great play in the backfield by Jalen Bedell, knifing across the face of the guard, getting upfield and stopping that one short. And another fourth down attempt. Let's see if the quarterback gets involved in the run game.
So already our third fourth down attempt if Oates fall to Governors. Take the snap.
Tim Zett said, scared money don't make money.
Plays off. Snead up the middle, lowers his shoulder. He's going to get the first down for Austin Peay.
And you're going to see that bare front by UC's defense covering up all three offensive linemen. And how about the push from Bucky Williams and Blake Mitchell, your left guard and center, driving that nose off the ball. You take care of the first level first, good things tend to happen.
I'll tell you what, if you did a blueprint of what I want my running back to look like, Brian Snead fits every bit of that blueprint. He runs hard.
And this is a team that lost a lot of carries in production from their backfield last year, getting it in droves early.
A play flake, Oates ball. Overthrows his intended receiver, but Aiko Harley. You are watching Austin Peay, Central Arkansas, in the first game of the 2020 football season. Matt Barry, Mike Golic Jr., Lawrence Sisler alongside in the Guardian Credit Union FCS kickoff, Montgomery, Alabama. And for a while, we were just wondering if we were going to get to see this beautiful sport again. And we can tell you, we are up and running. You can, in fact, play football safely. And we've seen that midway through the first quarter. Oates ball to throw off his back foot. Had Harley flag on the play. That one easy to call.
These receivers getting free early and defensive back saying, I'll live to play another day. We're not going to give up another long touchdown like we saw on that first play.
Number nine of the defense, 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
Harley 6'1", 195. Again, their coach is compared to Anquan Boldin, but still has the ability to stretch the field.
Absolutely, and that's good on good right there. That's Robert Rochelle. That's arguably your best defensive player on the Central Arkansas side, a 2019 FCS All-American preseason first team All-Southland Conference. And that time, that round goes to the offense. And we've seen early some conservative play calling early on from both sides, runs from Austin Peay, short passes from Central Arkansas. The training wheels are off now. We're going downfield.
We are midway through the first quarter. We've already had a touchdown, a couple of fourth down conversion for Austin Peay. And Oatesfall on the keeper, faked it to Snead, goes down right away. Tackled by Marquez Casey, gain of two. Oatesfall has that in him. Again, he got hurt early in this game a year ago, week two of the season. Said in our discussions with him earlier in the week, I don't know how much I'm going to run, but that's still in there.
They said he's a guy that if you told him he couldn't run, you'd be limiting him. He'd be chomping at the bit. He'd be in your ear on the sideline. He's a fiery leader. He's a tattooed quarterback. He's speaking to every hog up in front of him blocking like that. And they love seeing the effort on a run to get those extra yards.
So now second and eight. This time Oatesfall keeps it again. And I had mentioned, eighth play, week two in this game against Central Arkansas last year. This the play that injured Oatesfall, ended his season.
Really similar to what we just saw. Trying to make someone miss upfield and you just plant wrong. That Liz Frank injury sidelined him. And he said it was a perspective change. He got to take off the helmet and put on the headset and start to help out from that standpoint. Realized how much he enjoyed coaching.
Told us it was a blessing in disguise because in injury, having to watch Javon Craig lead the team who's now on the staff. He said he now knows that he wants to be a coach and he uses the injury as a blessing to help him through and figure out what he wants to do. So a big third down now for Oatesfall in the Governor's offense and a quick throw over the middle behind his receiver. Intended for Minter falls incomplete.
And Matt, what you're seeing early from Jeremiah Oatesfall is a little issue on some of the timing routes, some of the short area things. Everyone's had a fine time going deep and trying to throw up these 50-50 balls, but it's over the middle where all of a sudden that timing disrupted by this offseason. You don't have nearly as much time under task with those receivers, and now all of a sudden it leads to little off-target throws like that.
I will say, early on, we had wondered with no spring ball and your camp kind of wonky, not as sloppy as I think both coaches were concerned. You had the special teams gaffe a minute ago, and we'll see if they can get a punt off cleanly for Central Arkansas this time. Cole needs to kick, snap low, but he's able to get it off. It's going to be down at the 13-yard line. So that's where we'll see Braylon Smith and Central Arkansas take over. Down 7-0, 4 minutes left in the first quarter. College football here on ESPN.
Ever wonder why someone would wake up at the crack of dawn just for a chance at the unknown? Maybe a better question is, what are you waiting for? Pacifico is brewed for those who follow their own path. That's living life anchors up.
Quantro?
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 We think about it all the time, but for many Americans, it's a scary thought. During this crisis, 1 in 12 seniors and 1 in 7 children don't have access to nutritious food. We can all help. Get involved at feedingamerica.org.
It's Monday, BYU and Navy meeting our Labor Day primetime college football matchup. Last time they met, 1989, old Ty Detmer led the Cougars over the Midshipmen in Annapolis. Reese Davis, a great Kirk Herbstreit on the call, 8 Eastern on ESPN and the ESPN app. I know they are watching tonight, excited for the return of college football, as is that guy, wondering, like, he's like, human, are you going to bring me to the game?
You know what? Ask and you shall receive. This is a good boy-friendly game and certainly a dog-friendly broadcast, Matt.
Again, 2,000 fans tonight, socially distanced. Good to see some sort of fan experience in Montgomery at the Crampton Bowl, state capital of the great state of Alabama. Braylon Smith and the Bears with the ball, 13-yard line, a play fake, quick throw to the middle, tipped, falls incomplete. Jack McDonald got his hands on it early.
Mark Powell called him an old-school Big Ten linebacker, but how about the wiggle here? Bites on the fake a little bit, but gets back in that hole in time, and they're trying to suck him down with that play-action fake. Not fooled, gets up, makes a great play.
So Cameron Myers now in the backfield.
And they got him there. They saw the pressure with the dummy count.
Smith again to throw, drops it to Myers out of the backfield. And a quick tackle again. Jack McDonald on the tackle.
And so now third down. We know exactly what Braylon Smith's wired to look for here. It's going to be Lawan Winningham or Tyler Hudson, whichever one's got one and one on the edge, over to that single side. And it looks like Hudson's going to be over on the left side of the formation, singled up. We see him pressed out there. I'd be shocked if Braylon looks elsewhere.
And a quick handoff to Myers, who breaks it off the left side. And a big gain for Cameron Myers. Moves the chains, 24-yard first down Bears.
And so you see the five-man pressure up front coming from all angles and hit him with the draw. Great job by Toby Sanderson, the center, absorbing the blitz there, walling off the defenders and giving his rusher a lane. You want to stop a blitzing defense? Hit him with a couple of those early.
And a big first down for the Bears, who hadn't been able to get really anything going on those fourth down conversions. That pass falls incomplete, intended for Lawan Winningham.
Both quarterbacks working through some accuracy issues early on these short area throws, but the coach is still trying to, almost like a basketball player we've seen inside the NBA bubble, just let a ball go through the basket, start to get that rhythm back after a long offseason.
High percentage passes to get the confidence going. Again, Myers in the backfield, and again, Cameron Myers giving Central Arkansas a little pump of offense, 10 yards and another first down.
Motion out of the backfield, gets the linebacker to move, create some space, and history, we've got a tackle by number zero.
And here we go, tempo, Smith, play fake. And he's just gonna give up there. goes down for a minimal gain. Now, you heard Golic Jr. say history as Cordell Jackson makes the tackle. Tell the good people at home why number zero is historic.
This is the first time college football is allowing players to wear that single digit zero, a rare bit of common sense. Everyone loves the single digit so much, let them rock it. So you had Troy Henderson making that tackle. I, for one, would like to see it only worn by defensive linemen over 310 pounds, but I don't make the rules here.
Congratulations, Troy Henderson. You are now the answer to a trivia question. Second and 11, Smith, good toss there to Winningham over the middle. And a gain of 8. So third and 3 coming up for Central Arkansas.
And you saw the last time Austin Peay brings pressure, you get hit with a draw. Number one rule as an offensive line, if you don't want to see a blitz again, stop it the first time. Would it be interested to see if Austin Peay all of a sudden backs off, maybe plays a little coverage here?
This time, nothing doing for Cameron Myers, held for no gain. And this has been the down the distance, right around the same portion of the field here. There's a minute 30 left in the first quarter, where we've seen them go for it two prior times. May as well stay out there and do it again.
And a lot of the play calls have been indicative of a team that understood on third down they were going for it on fourth. And so you can make sure you're calling a play, setting yourself for another manageable down and distance here.
Already 0 for 2 on fourth down tonight. This time Smith takes it outside, pitches it to Myers, and that's going to be close. First down, Central Arkansas.
Great job by Braylon Smith here, holding as long as he can, challenging that outside shoulder of the defender, and then finally letting it go there. A great option against a team that had been bringing edge pressure on this drive.
And Kier Crossley back in the backfield. He got the start for Central Arkansas. And a quick throw up top intended for Tyler Hudson falls incomplete.
The battle going on the outside net right now is fun to watch. And again, it is personal for these Austin Peay defensive backs. They remember how that game ended last year, 43-yard touchdown, 18-yard touchdown for a fourth quarter comeback for Central Arkansas. They're making sure it's not on their shoulders again.
I love talking with Dominique Bowman, the defensive back. This defense gets their attitude from Bowman, and he was fun to watch. He made me want to throw a hat on. That's Crossley, nothing doing for him. Said he tells his defensive backs in the meeting, if you're juiceless, you're useless.
The combination of him and Mark Powell, they said they get to be kind of good cop, bad cop. They're the yin to their yang in this situation. And you see it's worked out well for a defense that really embodies the best of both of them. Smart, cerebral, but ready to fly downhill and attack.
All right, so third and 9 as we come to the end of the first quarter in the Guardian Credit Union FCS kickoff. And I'll tell you what, we couldn't have got this thing better started than we did with C.J. Evans' 75-yard first play of the game. College football is back on ESPN.
Ever wonder why someone would wake up at the crack of dawn just for a chance at the unknown? Maybe a better question is, what are you waiting for? Pacifico is brewed for those who follow their own path. That's living life anchors up.
Control?
Day trips are better than daydreams. Experience the thrill of a bigger world in a Lexus high-performance vehicle. Visit your local Lexus dealer in person or online for exceptional offers at the Golden Opportunity Sales Event. Experience amazing at your Lexus dealer.
Throughout the world of sports, we've seen social justice take front and center. NBA, NFL, now college football, a demonstration of social unity tonight at kickoff for Central Arkansas. They locked arms with each other, raised their fist at kickoff. as a show of solidarity with their teammates. Nathan Brown, their head coach, told us this week as we go with regards to the discussions he's had with his team. He said, as a person, I've grown a lot better and more open. The conversations he's had with his quarterback, Braylon Smith, he said is something he will never forget to build their relationship as they begin this season. Now 3rd and 9 for Smith, and again, he is forced to scramble. It is picked off. Jack McDonald intercepts it to start the second quarter for Austin Peay, Governor's Ball.
You'll see number 18 in the middle of the screen. Again, their defensive coordinators said he was an old school Big Ten linebacker. I'm not going to lie, he's moving a little better than a box linebacker. Great job flushing, getting pressure, and breaking on the ball right there. He understood the quarterback was going to be looking for a bailout in that check down. Breaks on the ball, makes a hell of a play. Turnovers, miscues on special teams. We knew they were going to be a part of this game, showing up early.
Preseason all VC, OVC for Jack McDonald. Showing every bit of it right there. Coaches love his motor. And so it'll be Jeremiah Oatesfall and the Governor's offense taking over.
Delay game, number 6 of the offense, 5-yard penalty, first down.
Matt, we saw that demonstration pregame by Central Arkansas. Really, this offseason, as a former college football player, watching these athletes find their voice has been one of the most fulfilling things I've ever seen. And it's been on this front, saying we want our voices heard when it comes to our lives mattering, our black teammates being heard and being valued for the great men that they are. And seeing that unity, the solidarity in locker rooms coming out to the field is huge.
Braylon Smith told us that it changes a locker room, and it's changed the locker room for good. His own fall goes up top, and it's caught by Jordan Pollard. What a catch by Pollard, 37 yards and a first down for the Governors.
And getting up to the line and getting ready to go. This is a team that did a lot more hurry up as an offense last year. Offseason limitations were going to make that hard, but a great spot to pick and choose when to pick up the pace.
And how about C.J. Evans? He won't go down, taking the ball inside the 10. Tackled by T.J. Campbell. Another look at that catch from Pollard.
Great concentration. Again, the hand fighting going on all day on the outside here, this time between DeAndre Lamont and Pollard there. Great focus to be able to come back, make that back shoulder catch, and set them up for a great trip in the red zone.
I'll tell you what, Golic Jr., if there's been a storyline for this Austin Peay offense, it has been these running backs, C.J. Evans, Brian Sneed. A look there from Pollard stepping up without D'Angelo Wilson, their star receiver, making the trip. So far, Marcus Lovins has to feel good about the guys stepping up for his offense.
Absolutely, and this is a great spot to keep an eye on Jay Parker. Small body on the field. As there's a review going on now, the officials are going to take a look under the hood. 7-0 here.
Ever wonder why someone would wake up at the crack of dawn just for a chance at the unknown? Maybe a better question is, what are you waiting for? Pacifico is brewed for those who follow their own path. That's living life anchors up.
Quantro?
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 Nobody likes an awkward silence. You can actually use it for something good.
You haven't really been yourself lately. Are you okay?
Find out how you can help a friend with their mental health at seizetheawkward.org.
So the play was reviewed, the catch from Jordan Pollard. The replay official had buzzed it in prior to the run from C.J. Evans, so that 15-yard run does not count. However, this great catch by Pollard does.
Take a look again at the concentration, going to the ground, and it's important maintaining control. Anytime you're going to the ground now, got the 1 foot in, and to be able to hold on to it securely and then make that next move ultimately is why he brings this one down. Again, with all that contact, can't overstate how impressive that is.
So the catch from Pollard stands. 15-yard run does not by Evans. So it'll be first and 10. 22-yard line for the Governors. That's Brian Snead back in the backfield. And a nice cut outside for Snead. And a hard run. Ball comes out, falls out of bounds. Gain of 9 for Snead.
Great job almost taking 2 here on the edge. Number 57, the left tackle, Garrett Bell, working on the end. Gets just enough of number 4 coming over there as we see the fumble out of bounds, thankfully preserving possession for Austin Peay.
So Snead, 5 carries, 22 yards. He's had the most carries. C.J. Evans scored a 75-yard touchdown. He leads the way with 77 yards. But early on, they've made their running game a priority.
And you've seen when it's hitting with the running backs like this, it means that quarterback option version of this backfield set all of a sudden going to start to open up as these linebackers bear down.
So now first and 10 as the Governors in the red zone to give to Snead. Another cut outside, and Snead takes the ball inside the 10. Tackled by Malik Wilson. Gain of 3.
Malik Wilson filling downhill early on in this one. And the way we've seen this play call, it seems like Austin Peay could be content to keep grinding this out on the ground. We know fourth down, no stranger for either of these teams.
I'd say it's been a good mix of aggressive and a good mix of get the ball conservatively, run the ball, make that a priority now. Second and 7. Again, give it to Snead. Left side, short gain. Tackled by Dre Matthews.
And we talked all about Austin Peay's defense rallying to the ball. Dre Matthews in this Central Arkansas side would like a word here. Chasing down from the backside. Those are all effort plays in this situation. Stringing out along the front and then let your guys make a play and force now a third and medium here in the low red zone.
It's a defense that returned 9 of 11 starters from a year ago. A lot of experience on this side of the ball. Nathan Brown and defensive coordinator Chad Williams said that if there's going to be a unit that keeps them in games, it's going to be this experienced defense. So now 3rd and 6. Snead takes the ball off the left side and met immediately by Cameron Godfrey. What great pursuit out of Godfrey to make that tackle on Snead.
You're seeing all those familiar faces around the ball, and this is just a situation where you get great penetration by Caden Brown. They force him to bounce outside. But if you're Snead, knowing down in distance, they called that again with fourth down in mind. You got to get upfield, not bounce it, lose the yardage that forces the kick here.
So Grant Paulette lines up for the field goal. Oldsfall, the holder. Snap, keep clean, kick up and good. As Austin Peay takes a 10-0 lead here in the second quarter. 28-yard field goal good. We're back after this.
Ever wonder why someone would wake up at the crack of dawn just for a chance at the unknown? Maybe a better question is, what are you waiting for? Pacifico is brewed for those who follow their own path. That's living life anchors up.
Control.
Day trips are better than daydreams. Experience the thrill of a bigger world in a Lexus high-performance vehicle. Visit your local Lexus dealer in person or online for exceptional offers at the Golden Opportunity Sales Event. Experience amazing at your Lexus dealer.
College football means to me somewhere where we can, you know, escape from the outside world, what's going on today, a place where we can compete, have fun, and build lifelong friends.
College football is something that I've dreamed about since I was a little kid.
Without football, I wouldn't know where I'd be.
A place where, you know, you get to come together and be together, part of a team.
College football to me means life.
Thankfully, Austin Peay gave me the chance to fulfill those dreams.
It just brings my family together, and I feel like college football does that around the world.
While there are those that go on to have success and fame in the NFL, college football is not a minor league for the NFL. It's its own beautiful sport that plays on Saturdays throughout the country. And this is an example of it tonight with Austin Peay in Central Arkansas as you hear what this sport means to them.
It's a year-round cycle for all of these players, the amount of time they spend with their teammates, their coaches, to try and come out for these 12, potentially 13 Saturdays of fall and get to put their gifts on display. And you've seen this offseason's given that a whole new meaning for a lot of guys that put on a helmet.
So Grant Paulette set to kick for Austin Peay, Cameron Myers, and Christian Richmond deep to receive for the Bears. Paulette's kick goes into the end zone, a touchback for Central Arkansas. And coming up next Monday, BYU and Navy meet in our Labor Day primetime college football matchup. The last time they met, 1989. How about Ty Detmer? Led the Cougars over the Midshipmen in Annapolis. Reese Davis, Kirk Herbstreit on the call, 8 Eastern on ESPN and the ESPN app. It is not Labor Day without a good college football game, and it is so good to see Notre Dame, one of our service academies, playing football again.
Absolutely. Navy and Notre Dame were supposed to kick off this season in Ireland. We remember that was part of the original plans that, like everything else, had to change. Really happy to see the Midshipmen still out there putting on a show with that triple option attack.
You could do a whole series as a player, LaJuan Winningham, quick to get started on play. You can do a whole series on what our service academies mean to the sport of college football. Not only what they do to just play, but what they're headed for after their playing career. So to be able to save the season for Navy to just get out there and play Notre Dame is a great sight to see.
It really is incredible, and having a chance to play the service academies during my time at Notre Dame, but to get to see my first Army-Navy game up close, it's just different.
It's one of the great Saturdays in this sport. Braylon Smith, quick shovel pass there to Cameron Myers in the backfield. Tackled by Tyquay's legs.
And they saw the bit of underneath action there. Might be time to get back to some of those screens along the perimeter that we saw. Austin Peay loading up on the box here.
You surprised we haven't seen them take more shots with the experience they have at quarterback and Braylon Smith?
A little bit early, but you've seen them a bit erratic on some of these short throws. I really think they're still trying to find that rhythm.
So that was a loss of three for Myers. Now second and three, and again, Smith forced out of the pocket. Completes the throw to Jack Short. And Jack Short takes out half of Austin Peay's equipment on the sideline. First and 10, gain of 27.
Watch two in white. Gerard Barnes drawing all the attention coming across that formation. And Jack Short sneaks out to the right side, gets in the flat, and shoulders the heating unit for good measure. Lay the lumber, big fella.
Why do we have a heating unit?
I think it's more of like an AC unit, maybe. I was never sure what that did.
All right. Nonetheless, big play for Smith. Again, he goes up top, and what a grab by Tyler Hudson.
I think he got the feet down. Wow, what an effort.
Now they're going to wave it incomplete, but let's have another look as Hudson.
Oh, trying to toe tap by the sideline. I think Braylon Smith heard us talking in studio, as this should be a great look at it.
That left foot.
It's the timing of that left hand and left foot.
Tyler Hudson, Southman freshman of the year last year. Smith, again, he's had to play a lot of this game out of the pocket. Pass falls incomplete. Let's go down to our Lauren Sisler.
Yeah, guys, offensive coordinator and QB coach Ken Cullums, also a record-setting quarterback here at UCA, said every quarterback has a panic button located somewhere, and yet Braylon Smith has never hit it. He just takes responsibilities, rolls with the punches, and doesn't get shaken. You can see that as they've continued to go on it on fourth down. Even his demeanor stays the same, whether he gets hit hard or he throws a touchdown. He's even keel, and he's an extremely poised quarterback.
Lauren, that's a great point. They said with Smith, the first quality you want your quarterback is toughness.
who's got every bit of that, is again, he's played a lot of this game, forced out of the pocket from this Austin Peay defense. Now 3rd and 10. Smith able to stay in the pocket there, to good throw over the middle to Hudson. That'll be enough for the first down to move the chains for Central Arkansas.
And to be able to fit that ball in the tight window, you're going to see number 4, Kobe Perry, as he puts that ball just over the top of the defender, right in that gap in the zone defense for a great first down.
Gain of 18, now a little bit of tempo as Cameron Myers takes it up the middle. Mason Harwell on the tackle, just a gain of 1.
This was a ground game that only averaged 88 yards rushing per game last year. Plays like that, passing to set up open run lanes for a unit that had struggled with that so mightily, might be the medicine to making this a bit more of a balanced attack.
Myers off the left side, makes a nice little wiggle there at the line of scrimmage. Tackled by Cameron Miller, good for 7, going to be 3rd and short.
That ground game opened up now. Let's see, we always called these the money downs in obvious situations. You work all offseason so that when everyone in the stadium knows you're going to run or pass, you're out here and able to execute. Expect Austin Peay to load up the box. You see the personnel change going right now. Some bigger bodies, some fresh bodies making their way on the field for an important 3rd down.
And selfishly, as an offensive lineman, this one you guys get to eat. 3rd and short.
You want to go out there and say, coach, let us lean on him up front.
See if they lean on him up front with Cameron Myers. Smith, however, is going to throw quick over the middle, and a quick completion going to be good enough for a 1st down caught by Dwight Blake.
The stat line only says 7 of 18 right now, 8 of 19, excuse me, for Braylon Smith. But this drive, we've seen a lot more of these connections. The accuracy starting to tick up, finding that rhythm as we get to the middle of the 2nd quarter.
So again, the tempo out of Central Arkansas. Now inside the Austin Peay 20 up the middle, immediately tackled. Great defensive play by number 4, Kobe Perry.
Linebacker number 33, Cameron Miller, meeting the back in the hole on that one. You saw the lead by the tight end. He fits that, and it allows that ball carrier to stop for just a second, long enough for them to track him down from the backside.
So no gain on the play, 2nd and 10. Smith looks left, throws left, and again another quick hit and a completion for Central Arkansas. That Jared Barnes, tackled by Troy Henderson.
Field shrinks now. You start to get down into the low red zone here around the 12-yard line. This Austin Peay defense has been sitting back, 2 high safeties. We know what they want to do. Close off the middle of the field, harass the quarterback. Let's see if they get aggressive down here.
That our first timeout of the game. Central Arkansas driving down 10-0 here midway through the 2nd.
Ever wonder why someone would wake up at the crack of dawn just for a chance at the unknown? Maybe a better question is, what are you waiting for? Pacifico is brewed for those who follow their own path. That's living life anchors up.
Control?
Day trips are better than daydreams. Experience the thrill of a bigger world in a Lexus high-performance vehicle. Visit your local Lexus dealer in person or online for exceptional offers at the Golden Opportunity Sales Event. Experience amazing at your Lexus dealer.
The Guardian Credit Union FCS Kickoff, presented on ESPN by GEICO, is brought to you by Guardian Credit Union. Think local. Think Guardian. Guardian Credit Union, where you belong. And Corona Extra. Find your beach.
Hall of Famers, Terrell Owens, Super Bowl champions, Adam Vinatieri, all a part of the great college football played at the FCS level. 2,000 fans allowed in the stadium tonight to watch the Guardian Credit Union FCS kickoff right now. Austin Peay up 10-0 midway through the second quarter. Matt Barry, Mike Golick Jr., Lawrence Sisler on the broadcast. 3rd and 3 for Smith and the Bears. He goes back shoulder, intended for Whittingham, and it falls incomplete. I think Whittingham wanted a flag.
That's the battle we've seen all night. Isaiah Norman, number 8. For that Austin Peay defense, and Whittingham battling, and give these refs credit. They are letting them go after it. You've been given the green light to be physical on the perimeter, and these DBs taking full advantage of it. As you see there, hand on the chest plate, looks like obvious interference and a missed call.
So a field goal attempt for Hayden Ray to get the Bears on the board from 30 yards out. Kick up and good. So the first points of the night for Central Arkansas, 10-3 is the offense. For the Bears, a little slow to start. Lauren Sisler, what have you seen down there on the sidelines?
Yeah, one big observation I'm seeing is with the masks and Coach Brown having to pull that mask up and down constantly as he's trying to communicate with the guys on the field and then communicate into his headset. And it appears that he's really having trouble conveying that message to the guys in an efficient manner and to where they can hear him and see his audibles.
And I'll tell you, is a guy, Nathan Brown, who could sling it in his own right here at Central Arkansas, holds just about every quarterback record this school has. As a quarterback and someone who's used to the communication, that's got to be driving him nuts.
Got to be immensely frustrating. We see you can practice that during the course of fall camp all you want, leading up to it. But when you get to those game reps and all of a sudden it counts for real, you hear that frustration mount. But you mentioned all the passing yards on this. How about Nathan Brown, Ken Collins, also former Central Arkansas quarterback, as well as tight ends coach Ryan Howard. Between the three of them, 20,450 passing yards, 181 touchdowns, all for Central Arkansas.
Tell you, these guys, they can send it still probably in practice as Hughes Ford set to kick off for Central Arkansas after scoring their first points, now 10-3. Benico Harley deep to receive for the Bears, along with Leland Wilhoit. And Benico, an opportunity to return this, takes it outside the 15, then immediately just shy of the 20. The next stop on the F1 schedule is the Rolex Belgian Grand Prix at the legendary Spa Circuit. 3-time champ Lewis Hamilton continues to dominate this season's driver standings. Tomorrow, 9 a.m. Eastern, ESPN and the ESPN app. Never been to Belgium? Visit. Beautiful place.
Great waffles. That's about all I know, Matt.
Great beer.
Beer and waffles honestly sounds like a trip you and I could handle.
Sounds like a kegs and eggs breakfast on a Saturday morning as we get Oatsball. That Governor's offense back out onto the field. C.J. Evans, the deep back. Oatsball to throw deep. Pass nearly intercepted. Flag on the play. That Robert Rochelle on the coverage.
This is now the second penalty we've seen on Rochelle, who's looking across the sideline at those Austin Peay defensive backs, wondering how they're getting away with everything, and he's getting the flags. This is an important play out of this formation for Austin Peay. We've seen this full house backfield, but now show passing action off this, and you see the grabbing and holding right there on Eugene Minner there. Obvious pass interference, but to now show that out of that look, one that's been primarily run for them through the first quarter and a half here of play, creates some, you know, a sense of disguise now for the defense, a little uncertainty.
It was one-on-one coverage with Minter, and Minter's an athletic tight end, 6'4", 225. We've seen Oatsfall target him a number of times tonight, just another added weapon for the Governor's offense. Now 1st and 10 on the 37-yard line. A little stutter step out of Evans, all for naught, tackled by Davis Harrison.
You've seen Evans have a lot of success fighting for those extra yards. Smaller guy, 5'9", 182, not going to bruise you up, but fighting for tough yards in between the tackles. That's always the knock on some of these smaller backs, but we remember the Christian McCaffreys of the world who didn't get the credit for being the between the tackles runners that they truly were. CJ showing off a lot of that short area quickness.
True freshman out of Mobile, Alabama. He was in the 7A All-State All-Star game, the Mississippi-Alabama All-Star game, and he's got quicks, as we saw on the opening play of this game. Now 2nd and 7 for Austin Peay. Oates ball fakes, whistle blown, and a flag on the play. So technology for the officials early tonight, they're using electronic whistles. So because of COVID protocol, they're not putting the whistle in and out of their mouth throughout the game if they're going in and the word was used, spittle going all over the place with the whistle. They're using electronic whistles where the noise emanates from something on their belt.
We talked about the masks for the coaches, yeah. The protocol for the players. Even the referees are not immune to everyone having to make adjustments during these uncertain times.
So what I'm wondering if sometimes they're pressing the whistle button as opposed to the microphone button. Week one, we'll get there. C.J. Evans in the backfield and a nice cut up the middle. Hit hard by Cameron Godfrey. But a nice gain for 7 yards for Evans.
C.J. Evans on the field. Brought down by Cameron Godfrey.
Yards on the night. We know a lot of that coming in one run as he gets a blow right now. And having Snead out there, having some depth in that backfield now as you're breaking in new runners after losing your top group from last year, most all of your production in that position.
And I'll tell you, Evans Jr., Brian Snead is in the backfield now, but impressive. 3rd and 5 for Oates ball, forced out of the pocket, throws across the field, falls incomplete, intended for Vincent Taylor. And the Governors are going to have to punt.
Again, a bear look up front. You see all three players covered inside. That twist creates some pressure, shortens the edge, and gets a hit on Jeremiah Oatfall. Both of these quarterbacks have really struggled flush from the pocket tonight trying to set their feet and throw.
J.W. Jones brings the pressure, lays one on Oatfall after the pass was thrown. Cole Deeds, the punter. Tyler Hudson, deep to receive. Early in this game, we saw a snap go over Deeds' head. And that one low, and again, the snap, the issue. Deeds tries to pick it up, and the 2nd miscue on special teams for the punting unit for Austin Peay. Tackled by Dwight Blakey, and the Central Arkansas Bears now great field position to try to tie this thing up. Another miscue by that special team.
And this is the unfortunate part for Miller there you see on the snap. After that first one went overhead, the mind games began, and you knew he was going to be erring on the side of caution. He wasn't going to put the normal umph he's seen behind that snap 1,000 times in practice. And so you get a situation here where thankfully your punter's able to hold on to the ball, but now great field position and going for the end zone. I'm sure Central Arkansas trying to capitalize on this big swing.
And I thought you had made a great point. Nick Screenock is the long snapper. You make a great point with him. That's going to be in his head now for the rest of the game. He's been thinking about that after the first long snap that went over his head. Now he's got to deal with another bad snap. And now Central Arkansas, 10-yard line, 1st and 10. One-on-one coverage. Smith up top and overthrows Winningham.
Just like we said, going for the end zone coming off a play like that's a no-brainer. And he had him beat. He had all the one-on-one coverage you could have ever hoped for a receiver that size. Got to put him on him. Err on the side of underthrowing that. Let your big-bodied guy go up and make a play.
You look at Smith's number, a little bit of struggles tonight. 9-22, 87 yards in the interception. School record 3,700 yards a year ago. Now 2nd and 10. Up the middle to Crossley. And he's met immediately, tackled by Troy Henderson.
Great job by your offensive line trying to just create a hole up there somewhere as now you get another 3rd and 7 situation. And for me, if it ain't broke, don't fix it right here. You've got those one-on-one matchups. Your receivers have been getting wins out there. You just got to put it on. And if you're Braylon Smith in this situation, gain confidence by throwing a nice jump ball to a guy like Luan Winningham and give him another chance at it.
Smith steps up in the pocket. He is brought down immediately by Matthew Gale. And a big stop for the Governor's offense after the miscue on special teams forcing a field goal now for Central Arkansas.
Defense runs out on the field yelling sudden change, isn't able to bow up in that situation. That time, a great job by Gale. Getting loose, big play, big shimmy to follow.
So Hayden Ray on for his second field goal attempt. Kick up and good for Ray. And so Central Arkansas able to take advantage of the miscue to get 10-6. 26-yard field goal by Hayden Ray. 10-6, Austin Peay.
Ever wonder why someone would wake up at the crack of dawn just for a chance at the unknown? Maybe a better question is, what are you waiting for? Pacifico is brewed for those who follow their own path. That's living life anchors up.
Control?
Day trips are better than daydreams. Experience the thrill of a bigger world in a Lexus high-performance vehicle. Visit your local Lexus dealer in person or online for exceptional offers at the Golden Opportunity Sales Event. Experience amazing at your Lexus dealer.
Matt Berry, Mike Golic Jr., Lauren Sisler on the call tonight. Happy to have college football back 2020. Austin Peay up 10-6 over Central Arkansas. The Guardian Credit Union FCS kickoff being played in Montgomery, Alabama, state capital, the great state of Alabama. And throughout everything that we've been through with COVID, Hurricane Laura that moves through the area, it is just so good to see on a Saturday at the end of August as we approach September and Labor Day weekend. So good to see college football back on a Saturday night. Hughes Ford set to kick. Central Arkansas was able to get on the board with a couple of field goals. Now 10-6. Nathan Page, Leland Wilhoit deep to receive for the Governors. Page able to return that one, takes it up to the 24-yard line as we check into the studio with Kevin Connors.
And Matt, coming up at the half, we're going to remind America who's playing in 2020 and who's not. What a concept. We'll also get Trevor Maddich's thoughts on the idea of some possibly starting the college football season in November. Plus, who's the biggest threat to Clemson? All that coming up when you join me and Trevor Maddich at the half. Matt, week one, game one, and we're already speculating.
Come on, Case. I love those studio guys. Those studio crews on Saturdays. Rob Lemley, Riv, Steve Oling, Mike Diesenhoff all do a great job. Studio hosts are fantastic. Now first and 10 for Oates Fall and the Governors. And a shovel pass up the middle to C.J. Evans. Minimal gain for Evans.
Little shovel and some traffic right there, and it's all those little plays that are going to make the world a difference there. Matt, on that kickoff, it won't go down in the scoreboard or anything like that, but Nathan Page close to the sideline there, choosing not to field that ball potentially with a foot out of bounds, usually better off of bounce, but that close to the sideline, do you let it go out of bounds maybe? If you catch it with a foot out of bounds, it's just as good, and all of a sudden you improve field position.
Therein lies the gamble. You're thinking a kick returner always wants to return it. If it stays and takes a wonky hop back in bounds, then you could be in a different situation, but a great point from you. Now second and 7. And again, it's Evans up the middle. Tackled by Cameron Godfrey. Short gain of 2.
I appreciate the work Eugene Minner is doing. It's not always pretty, but we've seen him highlight in the pass game a couple of times there. Once a near miss and a penalty drawn and a play action shot, but he's getting down and working in the run game. And with tight ends, we know the technique's not always going to be perfect, but the effort to get your hat down in there and dig a guy out gets you some of those tough yards for third and medium.
So this is a big 3rd and 5 with Central Arkansas having a little bit of momentum on offense. If Austin Peay can convert, keep the ball, get something done here in the 2-minute drill, before the half. Oatesville pressured, able to get out of it, and just pushes it forward. What an effort, finds Benico Harley, and Harley off to the races just off the other side at the 50-yard line. That is the athleticism of Jeremiah Oatesville in a nutshell.
And great timing on the blitz. You got a free run at the quarterback there, and somehow Oatesville Houdini's his way out of the situation and then makes the freak show pitch to Benico Harley. A great run after the catch receiver in normal circumstances, and there he's off and running. What an individual effort by Jeremiah Oatesville.
23-yard completion, Oatesville to Harley, converts the first down, now under 2 minutes. 49-yard line for Austin Peay, still have two timeouts left. Play fake, pressured again. Able to avoid the pressure, what a block. No flag on the play as Oatesville again. You said Houdini and maybe a Patrick Mahomes-like effort there to shovel it out to Harley.
And you've already seen in the subsequent plays the softening effects on the defense.
So they did throw a flag, and it's a personal foul.
And that's frustrating for a lot of old school players who look and see those crackback opportunities as a badge of honor. But we know as player safety has become more and more a part of the game, coming back towards the line of scrimmage now, even getting in front of him in that situation, still a penalty.
Now Harley does lead with the shoulder.
Important to note,
didn't
because
lead
we
with
know
the crown of the helmet.
The targeting mechanisms that potentially come in play then, but you're right, leading with the shoulder, getting to the front, but that blindside opportunity that used to be just another part of the game, a chance for a great hit. We had a jacked up segment on NFL Sunday Countdown for the hell of it. But it's a different age and a different time, and understandably so, given the safety precautions needed in the game.
Thought it was a good looking hit. Bryant Snead, Oatesville falls and fumbles it on the pitch as he looks to pitch it to Snead. And Oatesville still down on the ground as he comes up a little limpy on his right ankle. But you clearly see him lose his footing as he's trying to pitch the ball back to Snead. Ball on the turf. DeAndre Lamont recovers for Central Arkansas.
You see coming across here, his feet get tripped up with number one, Jay Parker, who's coming underneath as that sort of underneath shovel option there. Loses his footing, and then the bad pitch after that. Right here, another look at it. Their feet get tangled up. And I'm sure for Jeremiah Oatesville, a lot of that limp was mental, thinking, not again, not after what happened last year in this very same game.
That's a flashback injury again. Oatesville lost for the season a year ago in this game. It was the second game of the year. Liz Frank injury, had surgery on it. But able to get off the field now. Braylon Smith and the Bears look to take advantage. Rolls to his left, throws across his body, and it's intercepted. Picked off by Nathan Page.
And more of these struggles outside of the pocket for both quarterbacks. You saw nothing but daylight right in front of Braylon Smith, taking the easy win in a situation like that, coming off the turnover. We know you want to go for broke coming off of that last play, that turnover by Austin Peay, but tries to throw back across his body as there's a flag down.
An eligible receiver downfield, I'll translate you for it, doesn't matter. Play declines, interception, Nathan Page. What an answer out of this Governor's defense after a quick turnover by the Governor's offense.
Scanning the field there, thought he had it open, and just as an example of rolling out away from your throwing arm, not being able to get enough power underneath it to put it over that defender for a wide open Tyler Hudson in the back corner.
Yeah, you see Hudson wide open. You know what he sees, but again, when you're rolling to your left and have to torque your body to get it out to the right.
It's nice when you're Patrick Mahomes. For the rest of humanity, unfortunately, those throws are a tremendous effort, and that time just not enough oomph behind that one as Austin Peay gets a reprieve after that fumble.
All right, so two timeouts left, minute 8 left in the first half. What kind of ball play you expect for Oatesville and the Governors here?
So it's Evans straight up the middle. You wonder if they're going to be content and get out of the first half with the 10-6 lead. As we see a second ago, steps on the foot of his receiver.
And for Oatesfall, I know some of these are read option looks. Get the ball out of his hands for the end of this quarter here. Get him into the locker room where he's got a chance to take a breath after a play that I'm sure was a major flashback.
And that Parker that stepped on it. You can see him wincing in pain when he came back out of the field. After Austin Peay was able to get the interception. But we are happy to be with you. Mike Golick Jr., Matt Barry, Lawrence Sisler. As we approach 10:30 here on the East Coast, this is the first football game of the 2020 regular season. Here's where we stand going into September. 6 of the 10 FBS conferences have said they will plan to play ACC, Big 12, SEC out of the Power 5. And 4 FBS conferences have elected not to play 2 out of the Power 5 and the Pac-12 and the Big 10. And then 15 of the 126 programs plan to play, which is not many. Central Arkansas, the most scheduled games of any FCS program, with 9.
And with 3 FBS games on the schedule, remember after getting a win last year early in the season.
So 2nd and 10 after the Central Arkansas timeout. Oatesfall runs, pitches immediately to Parker, and Parker takes a big hit by Nick Nakwasa. Nakwasa just knocked him big out of bounds.
And again, getting that ball out of his hands early here. Jay Parker, not a big body, and felt every ounce of that hit.
That's a good defensive name, Nakwasa.
It does. Easy puns off that one. We're only human. We can only take so much.
So another timeout for Central Arkansas. As they check on Parker. So Austin Peay, Central Arkansas, scheduled this game. Both of their conferences had elected not to play. The Ohio Valley Conference and the Southland Conference, they will not play their regular seasons. They were allowed to schedule out-of-conference games, or at least 3 of them. Austin Peay, Central Arkansas tonight, Pittsburgh and Cincinnati. The COVID restrictions that have come up throughout the year, this is what's going to be facing college football throughout the season. The daily health screenings, the weekly testing, which will happen 72 hours before kickoff. But just another added element for these players, for these coaches, that goes along with everything else in preparing for a college football season.
You're such a creature of habit when you get inside these facilities, and so adding it early in the summer when a lot of these programs got back, getting time to get used to that was pivotal for the success of a hopeful season.
So 3rd and 3, Oatesfall, quick shovel to Evans.
Double pass complete to C.J. Evans.
No gain.
Down by Adrius Brown.
Bring it up a 4th and 3 for Austin Peay.
And we see it looks like they're going to let this wind down, go timeout.
The Central Arkansas appears to have used their final timeout. See if they can't give one more go at it offensively.
And we know in this situation the difficulty for Austin Peay lies in that decision to potentially punt.
Let's talk about first-year head coach Marcus Lovins. Ascended to the interim coaching role July 7th. Mark Hudson spent the coach last year for Austin Peay, led him to 11 wins, resigned for family reasons. And here you have Marcus Lovins, first game as a head coach, told us he's living his dream. And what a great story it is to see him on the sidelines as a head coach of the Governor.
Said as soon as he got this job, he made sure he was spending time on Zoom meetings with every member of the organization, from the janitorial staff on through the rest of the team. He wanted to make sure everyone felt a part of this process, understood who he was, and got to know him. And this is a team that's used to him. That continuity, seeing a familiar face in that head coaching role, giving them an advantage.
My favorite part of how Lovins got the job, he was called by his athletic director on a golf course. 4th and 3 in Oatesfall. Little pooch punt. Executed to perfection at the 26-yard line, so a good punt there out of Oatesfall. But Marcus Lovins, you can tell his love of his team, his passion for his team. And he told us, look, he's got a lot of coaching influences that have taken him through his career, from Dan Mullen to Manny Diaz. He was on Mississippi State staff. Sylvester Croom was one of the coaches. that he looked up to, saying that the one thing Groom taught him as a coach was to care about your players.
And that really seems to be the theme that's echoed through this. And you mentioned that extends to the coaching staff. There are a lot of former Mississippi State influences on this staff, a lot of coaches that have spent that time together. And so when that group is comfortable, it permeates down through the team. It allows you to turn the keys over to a leader like Jeremiah Oatesfall, who really has the pulse of this locker room. The best teams are always player-led, but make no mistake, that connection between head coach and your star is the foundation of any success.
Tim Satz and his offense has Joe Moorhead written all over. He was able to execute that as whistles blow before the play.
Delay game, number three of the offense. 5-yard penalty, still first down.
Braylon Smith, you see in this game last year, 283 yards and 3 touchdowns. Not what we thought we'd see out of a quarterback. We had a school record last year with 3,700 yards passing, 32 touchdowns. No timeouts left for Central Arkansas. Smith forced to roll right, throws out of bounds.
And a great job by the three-man rush of Austin Peay being able to apply pressure. That's been the key all night for both of these teams to get the quarterbacks on the move, and we've seen them take advantage of that at times in the past, working that into a dialed-up part of their offense. But tonight, Braylon Smith, there's no question, when his feet are not set, he's been a different quarterback.
Both of these quarterbacks have the ability to run and use their feet to get out of the pocket, but at least to this point, Oatesfall has been the player that's been taking advantage of that. And a quick throw there to Dwight Blakey as he gets out of bounds.
As we look toward the second half, I think for Braylon Smith, one of the keys is going to be don't be afraid to run. There's been a lot of instances rolling out. He's had green grass in front of him. Take what's there. Give yourself more manageable situations for those shot plays you want to take down the field, and don't try and force something. That's something for both these quarterbacks to consider, knowing you want to make plays on a big stage.
So third and 10, 27 seconds left in the first half. That's just a handoff up the middle. Cameron Myers. Austin Peay with 2 timeouts left. And a gain of 2 for Myers, bringing up a 4th down. And Austin Peay has used one of those timeouts, and they'll have 1 remaining as they're set to get the ball back. Tomorrow, we'll have 2 more NBA playoff games on ESPN, ESPN Deportes, and the ESPN app. Celtics Raptors, game 1 of the Eastern Conference semis, 1 Eastern. Then it's game 6 between Kawhi and the Clippers and Luka and the Mavs. Coverage tips with the Jump at noon Eastern. And if there's a more exciting young player in the NBA than Luka Doncic, I want to know who he is.
Been an absolute star. We know the unfortunate meniscus injury for Kristaps Porzingis has had him off the court, but Luka Doncic has taken up that mantle. And given this Clippers team, one of the favorites coming into the playoffs, everything they can handle, no doubt, Dallas, a bright future there for a pair of great young superstars.
How about the Mavs have a Hall of Famer for years in Dirk? They get Luka, and that's just a seamless transition at perhaps when you have an all-time great for the Dallas Mavericks. So look forward to the NBA playoffs. Hughes Ford set to punt for Central Arkansas. Jay Parker deep to receive for the Governors. Parker fair catches that 35-yard line for Austin Peay. 1 timeout left, 12 seconds. Maybe a chance, play over the middle, get the timeout to use, get in field goal range, kick one, get to the half.
Try something here, but whatever you're going to do, you're going to make it low risk. We've seen that towards the end of the half, both teams, I think coming off that initial adrenaline rush, looking a little gassed here. Play's been a little sloppy towards the back half of the second quarter. You want to get to the locker room at halftime mistake-free and be able to assess and readjust some of the things you've seen through your first half of real football this year.
Conditioning was one of the things we ID'd going into the game. Without the spring ball and the full complement of a training camp, we wondered if that would be a factor. So Oatesfall and the Governors, they're just gonna sit on this one and go to the half up 10-6. So a lot of what we saw, what we expected, Mike, early fireworks and now settling in, perhaps a little bit tired.
Exactly, and now the goal coming out of halftime is get back to playing clean football, eliminate the mistakes we've seen for Austin Peay on special teams, make sure that both of your quarterbacks start to get into more comfortable, high percentage situations, and get the stars involved. We've seen tough play on the perimeters here with the defensive backs and these big bodied wide receivers. Keep going to the well. Eventually, those 50-50 balls are going to tip in your favor if you're Central Arkansas.
First play for the Governor, C.J. Evans took it 75 yards to the house. That our lone touchdown in the first half, and a couple of field goals for Central Arkansas. Let's check in with Lauren Sisler, who's with Coach Lovins.
Coach, football right now, of course, looks a little bit different, sounds a little bit different, feels a little bit different with all the COVID-19 protocols in place. How do you feel like your team has adjusted to those protocols leading up to this game and in game?
I think we're doing a great job. We brought 70 kids here. 70 kids are competing and ready to go. I mean, we couldn't start any faster than what we've done. We put 7 points up on the board, and we're ready to go from that standpoint right there, you know?
Limited time on the field, of course, over the spring and into the summer, conditioning a concern there. How do you feel that the team has adjusted to that in terms of its energy and stamina to be able to hold for this first half of the football game?
That's something that we can't control. We can control our attitude and our effort and how we attack each day. We're going to come in here, we're going to regroup, get a plan for the second half, and attack the second half. What we can't control is out of our hands. So we're going to try to control what we control and get after in the second half.
All right, thanks, Coach Lovings.
Thank you.
Matt, I'll send it back up to you.
Lauren, thank you. Socially distanced interview with Coach Lovings. Our halftime score, 10-6, Austin Peay. Coming up after the break, Kevin Connors and Trevor Matt have your halftime news. On ESPN, presented by Geico. Right now, 10-6. Austin Peay up at the half over Central Arkansas. Mike Golick Jr., Matt Berry alongside. Lauren Sisler, third member of our crew, is out there in Montgomery, Alabama. It is so good to have college football back on a Saturday night. Both of these FCS powers come in ranked in the top 15. Both of them have star quarterbacks. What stood out to you in the first half about what we saw out of both of these teams?
Big plays early, certainly. We obviously saw CJ go through the 75-yard run to start things off. One-handed catches, but also having to find that level a little bit there with some of the sloppy play early on. Defense stepping up big. Want to see both quarterbacks settle down, get some rhythm throws that are going to make those big plays downfield possible.
We've had a couple of COVID notes to watch. Again, this college football season is going to look unlike anything we've ever seen, which is with the COVID protocols, with the coaches on the sidelines. We saw Central Arkansas head coach Nathan Brown. Our Lauren Sisler reported that he was having a hard time with his mask, communicating in and out of the mask with his quarterback, Braylon Smith. So everyone working through the process of getting week one underway.
It's the first half of football in 2020. I will take some of these mistakes that have come because most of them have been made 100 miles an hour, and there have been a lot of big plays to go along with them right now. Coaches had to be encouraged in that halftime locker room, mostly because they have something to correct too, which
Mike Golick, if it was 0-0, I would take it just to have college football back on my screen. Grant Paulette kicks it off. Christian Richmond there to receive the ball at the 5-yard line. And Richmond has a seam up the middle. Takes it to the left side, and a good start to the second half for the Bears. Down to the field, and Lauren Sisler.
Yeah, guys, I talked to Coach Nathan Brown coming out of the locker room to get a feel for how he felt his team performed in the first half. The offense, he said, probably the worst output he's seen from this football team in a very long time. However, defensively, he was very pleased with their performance, their effort, and their stamina, despite the lack of conditioning that they've had. Now, one area of concern that he said he's having to adjust to is those electronic whistles from the officiating crew. He said they're very hard to hear and to be able to make those audible calls and be able to stay on top of things.
Lauren, thank you. Good field possession for Braylon Smith. The give up the middle to Kier Crossley. A good bounce outside for Crossley. Is Crossley a big run on first down? Early momentum for Central Arkansas. Good kick return and then a good run there out of Crossley. Gain of 17.
Sometimes the only medicine is to keep your feet moving and your head down. Justin Larry, their freshman right tackle, it's not a pretty block. You're not getting a ton of movement, but he stays engaged. And ultimately, Crossley able to make a play outside here.
And you know, as a record-setting quarterback at his alma mater, Nathan Brown not going to take the sloppy offense for too long. And we've already seen it in the first couple of plays. Crossley again, hard run off the left side. Tackled by Jack McDonald.
So going into the second half, if you're Nathan Brown talking to Braylon Smith, what I'm looking for is let's get some of those short rhythm throws back. His most successful drive as a passer, quick throws over the middle.
Second and five already in Central Arkansas territory. Again, Crossley right up the middle, and Crossley into the end zone. Touchdown, Central Arkansas. That's how you start the second half. Kierre Crossley, 34 yards.
Or just hand the ball off and follow the big fella. Number 75, the left guard, Will Burge, is clearing the way. And what a drive for Crossley on that one, getting his number called early and often to start the second half off. That'll make your head coach, a very offensive-minded one, smile awfully wide after a frustrating first half.
And it was sloppy, to use his words, but nothing sloppy about that, as Hayden Ray on to attempt the extra point. Snap is good, kick is good. In a minute into the third quarter, Central Arkansas, great kick return to set up a couple of big runs for Crossley, and now 13-10 Bears take the lead.
We get the drive recap here. It all starts with a great play on special teams here. You see a big time return to start off the half, coming out the locker room, juiced. And then it's simple. You've got numbers working in the box, bouncing outside here. And then the rest of the plays, it's just easy box look. Stack formation to the right and get easy light fronts to the left. Follow your big fella up the middle, all the way to the promised land there. A big drive for Kierre Crossley. As you see 75 getting up to the second level, getting locked onto the linebacker, and the rest, they say, is history.
Crossley, 9 carries, 74 yards and a touchdown. That was tonight's drive recap, brought to you by Guardian Credit Union. In a drive it was. Maybe we give Nathan Brown, head coach, maybe we give him all the credit for getting in there and saying, guys, play football. We know we can do this. And you've got Crossley able to come out, set up by the good kick return by Christian Richmond. And look at the rushing yards. It was clear they wanted to make that a priority tonight because they weren't able to do it against Austin Peay a year ago.
And just in general last year, just over 88 yards of ground, yards a game they averaged on the ground. Market improvement.
So Saren Hughes-Ford, his kick's going to go into the deep part of the end zone. It's going to be a touchback ball at the 25-yard line. And now it is time for Jeremiah Oatesville in that Governor's offense to see if they can respond.
And the biggest question is going to be, we saw Jeremiah Oatesville take a little bit of a fall. He got his feet tripped up, and we saw him get up, walking around a little gingerly. His health is going to dictate if they can go back to their favorite formation from the first half, that full house backfield, some option looks that make use of his mobility as a quarterback. If they can't, expect some more of the traditional spread looks we would see out of this Tim Zetts offense.
If you're just joining us, their star receiver, D'Angelo Wilson, did not make the bus trip down to Montgomery, Alabama. He, along with Benico Harley, two preseason all-conference players, left with just Harley as Wilson is not here. So first and 10 from the 25 for Oatesville, who's going to throw on first down, and he's going to look downfield in a nice catch hauled in by Jay
Pollard. We know had one of the most impressive catches of the first half. A physical job by him, and coming out throwing again out of that formation. Now the defense gonna sit back a little bit.
So we'll see if Austin Peay tries to stretch the field. CJ Evans up the middle. Tackled by TJ Campbell.
You mentioned no D'Angelo Williams. That was a guy that took up a lot of attention on your offense. And so this adjustment that we've seen, this full house formation, getting Benico Harley, Jay Parker, some of your great receivers in the backfield around your quarterback as easy weapons, maybe one of those packages you practice, understanding what happens if we're missing X player, Y player in a game situation.
Running game, as you see, Austin Peay's leaned on that heavily tonight. And again, the give to Evans. And again, that Central Arkansas defense there for the taking. Tackled by big J.W. Jones. Also, Adavius Brown there to help.
You mentioned J.W. Jones. He makes the play by clouding the read for the quarterback. Jeremiah Oatesville is looking directly at 50, who's giving him that middle ground look. He hands it off, and J.W. Jones has the athleticism to come crashing down and be a part of that play, setting up third and long here.
Yeah, big third and long for Oates Ball and the Governors after Central Arkansas took their opening possession of the second half and the lead 13-10. Oates Ball sets his feet, has the throw, falls incomplete. Intended for Eugene Minter.
Oates Ball pass.
Line does a good job passing off that twist, giving him space. And there's room in there. It's a difficult throw to thread it over the top of the linebacker level. And Eugene Minter's been a target they've gone after often and a big one.
So Oldfall still out of the field now, fourth and nine. Now here comes.
And watch that potential pooch punt again that we saw before. We know that snap on the normal punt unit's been a bit of an issue for them in the first half.
And that's a great point to look at it that way. And here we see it again. He just gets a roll out. A little bit of a pooch punt there. Recovered, caught by Tyler Hudson, who's going to run out of bounds. Pushed out by Jordan Pollard. And Mike, great point. Snapping and special teams has been an issue for the Governors early on. Oates Ball by extension has become the punter. As Central Arkansas gets the ball with the lead here in the third quarter.
Ever wonder why someone would wake up at the crack of dawn just for a chance at the unknown? Maybe a better question is, what are you waiting for? Pacifico is brewed for those who follow their own path. That's living life anchors up.
Cointreau?
Nobody likes an awkward silence. You can actually use it for something good.
You haven't really been yourself lately. Are you okay?
Find out how you can help a friend with their mental health at seizetheawkward.org.
When it's not football, I'm going around, I'm competing, I'm always in a competitive atmosphere. When you're roping, there's a lot of things you can't control. I mean, you're riding a 1,200-pound animal trying to rope a cow that has a mind of its own, and riding a horse that has a mind of its own. So I think the big thing in roping that's helped me is just knowing, controlling what you can control, and just making the most of your situation.
Central Arkansas quarterback Braylon Smith, a man of many talents, took up horsing after he lost his mother young. Lived with his aunt and uncle and his grandma and grandpa, and his aunt loved riding horses, and so Braylon Smith took up a love for a little lasso and a rope and riding, which he does there, and he's able to hit his target, Cameron Myers, out of the backfield. But Braylon Smith is the type of quarterback his coach said, Nathan Brown, he could lead this program to new heights.
Talked about the toughness, basically shattered his ankle in 2018. He was getting up and trying to get off the field on his own. It's the kind of grit that they value at that leadership position on their offense.
Myers trips over a couple of players in the backfield. And a loss of one. You know, like he set a school record last year, 3,704 yards. He had 32 touchdowns. He had every bit of a starring role for this team and a single season record. Let's go down to our Lauren Sisler.
Guys, I want to go back to this horse thing because it's a pretty cool story for Braylon Smith, something that he takes up in the offseason. Of course, he says during the season he's not doing the cattle roping, but he does love the cattle roping. Of course, he's got horses of his own that he loves to train, that he loves to ride. He's got two horses called Sister and Chunk. And guys, do you think we should tell them about the time he got himself in trouble his senior year while he was actually being recruited by Central Arkansas?
I'll tell it. It was a senior prank. He wanted to ride his horse to school.
For a sanctioned water balloon fight were having at school. He went to a way more fun high school than I did, apparently.
It was Cameron Myers for the first down as Braylon Smith in this offense seems to have found their rhythm. A play fake there to Crossley over the middle and a diving effort by Jared Barnes. It falls incomplete. But yeah, Braylon, a man of many talents, and I asked him completion percentage higher with the lasso or with the football, and he kind of just laughed because he said, look, I'll just take whichever one's going to get me more yards.
It is amazing the response you still get out of his offensive coordinator. Ken Collins was the one that brought this up to us on the Zoom meeting. His face lit up talking about his quarterback. You can tell the admiration and respect they have on this offensive staff for their signal caller.
He begged us to ask him about the horse race, and we did, and we got a good story out of it. As Kier Crossley met in the backfield by the all-everything safety, Cordell Jackson. And Lauren, you could just tell the love that they had for this quarterback and the leader he is on and off the field.
Yeah, no doubt about it. And Braylon has a really unique and special story. And you mentioned it before, losing his mom. His mom was just 27 years old, Braylon 5 years old at the time when she died in a car accident. But his mom comes from a lineage of great athletes. She was an all-star athlete there in Conway, Arkansas in high school, and then went on to play volleyball and basketball at UCA. And so she was a prolific athlete, and of course, losing her at an early age, his grandparents and aunt and uncle ended up raising him. And really, that's where he found his love for horses, his aunt and uncle, who kind of brought that into his life, Mario and Michaela. And that's really what got him sort of started in that, raising them and training them. And it's something he has an affinity for when he's not playing football.
Just a remarkable story, one we will tell throughout the season with these players who love coming and playing college football. Their third down attempt was short. Hughes Ford on to punt for Central Arkansas. So a good stop by the Austin Peay defense. Nathan Page fair catches it. He lets it drop. Oh, and a great opportunity missed for the Central Arkansas special teams to down that thing at the one. Either way, 25-yard line for the Governors. We'll take a look at Oates Ball and that offense when we come back.
Ever wonder why someone would wake up at the crack of dawn just for a chance at the unknown? Maybe a better question is, what are you waiting for? Pacifico is brewed for those who follow their own path. That's living life anchors up.
Control.
Day trips are better than daydreams. Experience the thrill of a bigger world in a Lexus high-performance vehicle. Visit your local Lexus dealer in person or online for exceptional offers at the Golden Opportunity Sales Event. Experience amazing at your Lexus dealer.
The Guardian Credit Union FCS Kickoff, presented on ESPN by GEICO, is brought to you by Guardian Credit Union. Think local. Think Guardian. Guardian Credit Union, where you belong. And Pizza Hut. Order today at pizzahut.com.
You are watching the 2020 Guardian Credit Union FCS kickoff on ESPN, presented by GEICO. So good to have college football back on a Saturday night. Mike Golick Jr., Matt Berry alongside. You heard from Lauren Sisler, our reporter there in Montgomery, Alabama, the capital of the great state of Alabama. So we get Jeremiah Oatesville and his Governors down 13-10 here, 9:23 left in the third quarter as these two FCS powers meet in the first game of the 2020 season. It is Brian Snead in the backfield, and Oatesville is going to fake it to Snead. He's going to go deep, has a receiver, and just overthrows Pollard. You make that connection, Mike Golick Jr., you get six.
We've seen no D'Angelo Williams on the field for them, and the lion's share of the touches going Pollard's way. And Oatesville just remains high on the throws tonight, overthrowing some wide open receivers. And you can see he's frustrated. He expects a lot of himself as the signal caller. He wants to be a point guard on this offense for the great guys that have so much run after the catch ability.
Missed opportunity there for Oatesville. He's going to take the snap and roll right. And again, misses the completion that intended for Jay Parker. At this point, third quarter, the rustiness conversation has to end with getting out there and having a full quarter and a full half of reps with a player that's been in this game before.
Absolutely, and this is where it's on the preparation leading up to this. If you don't have D'Angelo Williams, being able to slot some touches towards Jay Parker, who we haven't heard from much tonight in this one, try and make use of those great weapons they've got all over the field.
So now third and long, I think at some point he'll start looking again at Benico Harley's way. That a quick strike out of the backfield to Snead, and Snead, hard effort,
comes up short of the first down. Tackled by DeAndre Lamont. We've got an injured player on the field. It's Lamont who made the tackle. Lamont trying to make his way up the field. We'll check on him and come back after this.
Trips are better than daydreams. Experience the thrill of a bigger world in a Lexus high-performance vehicle. Visit your local Lexus dealer in person or online for exceptional offers at the Golden Opportunity Sales Event. Experience amazing at your Lexus dealer.
Here's the injury we saw a moment ago, DeAndre Lamont taking a knee to the head from Brian Snead.
And we saw him go into the tent. Just unfortunate there. He'd been having such a great night as a blitzer for them, making plays at and around the line of scrimmage. You hope he's able to get out of this one okay after a tough shot there, going in, trying to make a play low on a very big, strong running back in Brian Snead.
So something developing with the Austin Peay offense. Their normal long snapper did not make the trip. So you're seeing Jeremiah Oatesfall, the quarterback, he's been pooch punting it because there were snap issues with the backup long snapper, Cameron Miller, who's actually a linebacker, and the snaps have been all over the place. So they've elected just to keep the quarterback in there with the normal snapper, let him pooch punt it. And it's been working out since they figured out that, you know what, probably a little bit safer than what they've been doing. Next Monday, BYU and Navy meeting our Labor Day primetime college football matchup. Last time they met, 1989. My guy Ty Detmer led the Cougars over the Midshipmen in Annapolis. Reese Davis, Kirk Herbstreit off the call. 8 Eastern on ESPN and the ESPN app. One of the great traditions in college football, as you know well, Mike Golick Jr., Navy, Army. We finally get to see it, that coming up on Labor Day weekend. Braylon Smith, the Bears, back on the field. That's Crossley off the left side. Quick pitch to him and a good gain on first down.
This offensive line is really starting to go to work, and a lot of people think you want to let the big boys eat. You're running downhill. Sometimes those softball runs, the screens, the small draws inside give them just as good of an opportunity.
And again, we get tempo out of the Bears. Smith play fake off to the right side, and that is a big fella, Jack Short. We've seen him make a couple of plays. That's a player with a neck roll and long hair.
Tight end plus long hair plus neck roll equals boomstick. This is an incredible effort at the end of a play, and that fires a sideline and an offense up. A team that got rolling on the ground last series gets that kind of juice from their tight end.
That guy just looks like college football. Coach, I'm a receiver. Give me a neck roll.
Thank you, sir. And the beard.
Got the beard to go. Another look at this play. Jonathan Edwards on the business end of the Jack Short play.
And you see there, that's a prime example on the other side defensively from Jonathan Edwards on the need when you're going in on a tackle to keep your head up there. Dipping low, I understand it's a bigger player and the tendency is to go low on a tight end, but you can't hit what you can't see. And in that spot, you could very badly injure yourself if you're not careful on the side of the tackle.
Jack Short, 6'4", 245. Edwards, 6'2", 185. First down for the Bears. Smith back to throw. Over to the right side. Pass complete to Tyler Hudson.
These are the timing and rhythm throws from Braylon Smith that we saw and have success on in the first half. And here, a little high, but that's where you want to miss with these big wideouts he's got.
We're starting to see a little bit of rhythm now. Smith finding that tempo with the offense. And one of those electronic whistles goes off.
completed passing downs is 42.
They're going to have a look now at the Tyler Hudson completion there from a moment ago. So if you're just joining us and we're talking about all these protocols with COVID, a couple with the officials, they are in masks during the play. If they're socially distant, they pull it down. They use electronic whistles on their belt so not to have to go to their mouth all night. Golic Jr., what do you see?
I see control all the way through. I see feet down in bounds. I don't see a lot of issue here. Great job on the contest by Joseph Newberry, but he goes up for the catch there. And I thought that left hand was pretty secure on the ball through this portion of the catch as the feet get planted both in bounds. That's an NFL catch right there. That's good on Sunday.
Would you be angry with me? Hang on, we'll wait for the call. I read his lips. Completed catches confirmed. First down. I think that we should do like a running Mike Golic Jr. review tally for the season.
See if I get locked in here. I feel like I'm on a pretty good heater right now.
We're going to go one for one. And I would like to talk to our Rob Adamski, our all-world producer, to see if we can get that going. Matt Berry, Mike Golic Jr., Lauren Sisler, along. So I want to make this a thing. I mean, there's nothing at stake for you when you're sitting in a booth.
Put him on the board.
All right. Second and one. Quick look to Crossley over the middle. Caught Hudson. And he's forced out of bounds. A little eye candy there at the offense to get the ball to Hudson.
And I like these quick looks against a defense that wants to play downhill. They know Cordell Jackson, who he exchanged some words with at the end of that play, is a guy that wants to come screaming down like a missile. And so you get it out to the edge quick and let these wideouts try and work and wiggle. Early success.
Hudson, freshman of the year in the Southland Conference a year ago. They want to get him going. My favorite thing about Hudson, he had offers from Harvard, Cornell, and Columbia. He is smarter than both you and I. Oh, Aaron pitch to Crossley. Ball still on the turf. And Austin Peay has recovered. Kobe Perry takes advantage of the miscommunication as Central Arkansas just had a drive moving.
Once for Austin Peay in the first half, we saw Jeremiah Oates fall with issues on the option pitch. And these are timing plays. These are ones where being on the same page, being in phase, they call it, with the pitch option and the quarterback there, takes a lot of time and practice. And again, you wonder about the preparation because of all the limitations with COVID-19.
How important is pitch distance in that situation, quarterback to running back, and maybe expected it to be a little bit out further, but that was completely behind him, and Kobe Perry was able to take advantage. A bad turnover for the Bears. They had a drive move. Third turnover of the night.
And now for Jeremiah Oatesball and company. Go for the jugular here.
See if Oatesball takes a shot already in Austin Peay territory. Had the pump fake, pressured, and ends up being brought down by Jalen Bedell.
And just great work by the four-man rush, staying active there. That was a deep shot dialed up to go downfield, but a good job of getting loose, forcing the quarterback to step up into some pressure and preventing one big play from becoming another.
We've seen both of these quarterbacks pressured throughout the evening. Oates ball brought down, loss of two, second and 12. On the other side of the 50. Get there to C.J. Evans, tries to find some room, nothing there, brought down by T.J. Campbell.
And we've seen a lot of handoffs lately. We know Evans got loose for a big play. We know they've got Snead back in that backfield. Oatesball taking that spill in the first half. You wonder if there's a keeper that's lurking somewhere soon. If he takes this and all of a sudden has daylight in front of him, could be a big play waiting in the ground game for Austin Peay.
Under 6 minutes here in the third. Central Arkansas had the lead going into the first half, or Austin Peay rather. Central Arkansas grabbed it back as Oatesball fires deep, ball position, calling for a flag, and Jordan Pollard doesn't get it. Covered on the play by Stephen Mackey.
And Stephen Mackey not turning around, trying to make any play on the ball there. Got to be incredibly frustrating for Pollard in that situation. As we have another pooch punt situation likely set up here for the Austin Peay quarterback.
I'll tell you this though, the fact that they know that Oatesball's
the Pooch punter, don't think for a second that not dialing up a ball play that perhaps maybe later in the game you could fool punt and then throw it. But a complete game changer is Oldsfall. To be honest with you, he's acquitted himself quite well as the punter after the long snapping issues early on for the Governors. For more on a remarkable situation that's been in and around sports that has permeated into college football, we go down to our Lawrence system.
Yeah, guys, on their way into Montgomery, Alabama yesterday, Austin Peay stopped in Selma to walk across the historic Edmund Pettus Bridge where former Georgia congressman and civil rights icon John Lewis marched back in 1965. And afterwards, the team had a chapel service that followed with an open discussion about social justice and how they can demonstrate social unity and find that unity as a team on that front.
Lauren, great stuff. You know why I'm proud of these players and I'm proud of these college football players? Because the NBA, the NFL, those are paid professional athletes. These are college players exercising their voice and using it for something good and putting themselves out there and using that platform for, by the way, something they're not paid for, like pro athletes that we've seen do it throughout the week as Cameron Myers takes the ball up the middle.
It's a difficult thing at times to feel comfortable speaking up and speaking out. College athletes having a voice is not something, you know, I'm out of college just under 10 years now, and that wasn't something that was comfortable for a lot of our players back then. So to see the bravery on a lot of these athletes, the willingness to share their stories with their teammates, more than admirable. It's necessary for there to be continued progress.
Braylon Smith, the good pitching catch to LaJuan Winningham as he skips out of bounds. And again, before the turnover on the last possession, we've seen this type of rhythm, 26 yards to Winningham.
And a lot of cushion back off there, an easy decision for Braylon Smith, who's had some difficulty in his own right getting the ball out, but now the timing, the rhythm in the pocket with his feet set underneath him.
Smith under center, play fake, sets his feet, tries to touch one over the middle, falls incomplete. If you were just joining us, 11:30 on the east, 8:30 out west. If you're perhaps looking for SportsCenter, sorry, we've got live college football at the Crafton Bowl, Montgomery, Alabama. Austin Peay, Central Arkansas, two conference champions from a year ago. It's the first college football game of the 2020 season. Mike Golick Jr., I'm Matt Barry, Lawrence Sisler on the event, Montgomery, Alabama. With everything that we've been through through this 2020, which quite honestly has been an awful year, this a highlight to talk ball on a Saturday night. Smith rolls out, forced out of the pocket, goes down the field. And a great defensive effort there by Isaiah Norman to knock that ball away from LaJuan Winningham.
Just a diving effort, and I'm not even sure he got a finger on this ball as they force Braylon out of the pocket yet again. But just enough of a distraction around the receiver, being physical enough at the top of that to mess with the concentration on Winningham and make a great play and put them in a 3rd-and-10 situation now.
It's been a different energy or effort since these teams have come out of the locker room. It's almost as if they got to the locker room and said, you know what, guys, we're playing football. Get out there and go. 3rd-and-10. Smith designed run up the middle, has a couple of blockers. And that's going to be close to a first down as some Austin Peay defenders came in and had a free run at the quarterback, and they took it.
Everyone just a little too hesitant at the top of that play. It's a difficult situation as an offensive lineman going up on a screen to that second level, not knowing where the quarterback is behind you with the timing on that draw. But we saw if that group had just been going forward, Braylon Smith had enough head of esteem. 6'3", 210, that's a big body.
And hesitant coach Nathan Brown, who's a record-setting quarterback at Central Arkansas, was giving it to his quarterback there, perhaps for that hesitation as they forced the Hughes Ford punt. But Eko Harley deep to receive for the Governors. Has a little bit of momentum and makes a nice spin to get a couple of extra yards as we will take a look at Jeremiah Oldsfall and the Governors. Tomorrow we'll have two more Major League Baseball games for you. We've got the Yankees and Mets to wrap up their 3-game series for Eastern on ESPN2. Then on our Sunday night game, Braves and Phillies finish up their 3-game set at 7 on ESPN, ESPN Deportes, and the ESPN app, with a special StatCast edition on ESPN2. Jeremiah Oatfall, who just joined us, injured in this game a year ago, happened to be back for this team tonight. Six completions and four punts. Probably not
what he expected coming into this game or hoped for, but we've seen this formation, the ground attack and the option looks for this team have been much more of the flavor of the night. They had success early with some big plays, and it's really been timely shots as opposed to a consistent passing attack here. We know the punting situation, the result of the starting long snapper not making the trip and some mishaps with the backup, Cameron Miller, who's one of their linebackers, forcing them to a difficult situation. And Matt, those are the hidden yardage it plays that add up. Central Arkansas being able to have a normal complement of their punting attack to flip the field position at times, whereas Austin Peay's got their quarterback doing it.
C.J. Evans approaching 100 yards. Had a quick look to Jay Parker. Parker's able to reverse his field, try to get a block from Oatfall, and Parker able to reverse the field and pick up a nice game of a play that looked doomed to start.
Yeah, strange one here, a pitch out, getting it in the hands of Jay Parker, one of the quicker players on your team. And then your quarterback doing the perfect version of quarterback blocking. Get in the way, don't get hurt, we need you out here. But also appear in the frame and get credit for it in that meeting when we all watch film on Monday.
It's a gain of 13 and a first down. Yeah, just be a body.
That's all you got to
be
do.
A body. He did, first down. Oatfall moves up in the pocket. The big tight end, Eugene Minter, met immediately by T.J. Campbell. What a hit.
It's been amazing. We talked with the defensive staff from Austin Peay, Mark Powell, Dominic Bowman, the co-defensive coordinators in here. But it's been Chad Williams' group in Central Arkansas that's taken away the middle of the field. That was the goal for Austin Peay. But Central Arkansas, whether it's been DeAndre Lamont tonight, Malik Wilson, or on that last play that we saw from T.J. Campbell, they've sent a message with the tone they've brought over the middle of the field, and it's shown.
Can't overstate it enough, the loss of D'Angelo Wilson, who did not make the bus trip, how much of a factor that's had on some of the play calling for the Governors as Oatfall keeps the option. Brought down on the play by Caden Brown.
Oatfall, that's a big one for him mentally too. That's the first design carry we've seen for him since that spill in the first half on an option look where he got up, he was looking at his foot, and I'm sure the flashbacks had started from last year. Just, we always hear quarterbacks say going into the game, I want to take that first hit. Get in, you know, feel like a football player again, realize, all right, I can do this, I'm all right.
Third and six, under a minute, third quarter. Austin Peay down three. Play clock down to five. Oatfall. Good throw. Caught by Harley. First down Central. I beg your pardon, first down Austin Peay.
And this all happens because you've got an experienced quarterback willing to use the snap count as a weapon. You see the clapping here. He gets his line a look at the blitz that was coming. They pick it up perfectly, and he's got an easy pitch and catch downfield. Veteran quarterback using the snap count at his disposal.
And hurry up tempo, and again, a quick throw looking to Harley's way. We wondered if they would try to get Harley more involved, just two catches, 39 yards. He's the star of that dynamic duo between he and Wilson. Wilson didn't make the trip, leaving Harley out there. Not a big night for him, still a quarter to play, but you wonder if they start to make that a bit of an emphasis.
And we've seen the difficulty without D'Angelo Wilson to draw that attention. Jay Parker and Benico Harley have become less of an option, maybe the normal receiving, but we've seen the short area in those backfield sets getting creative with their players.
Ball set at the 37. Oatfall, another design run. Nice cutback right, moved his way back left. That could do it for the third quarter as Oatfall was only able to get one on the play. But again, you're talking about a confidence builder for a player. We saw Nick Duck towards the end of the first half. As we go to the fourth quarter, 13-10. Central Arkansas leads in the first college football game of the season. It's close, it's fun, we've got quarterbacks, but most importantly, we have Jack Short in football. Let's play the fourth quarter coming up next on ESPN.
Ain't no devil gonna
Ever wonder why someone would wake up at the crack of dawn just for a chance at the unknown? Maybe a better question is, what are you waiting for? Pacifico is brewed for those who follow their own path. That's living life anchors up.
Control?
Day trips are better than daydreams. Experience the thrill of a bigger world in a Lexus high-performance vehicle. Visit your local Lexus dealer in person or online for exceptional offers at the Golden Opportunity Sales Event. Experience amazing at your Lexus dealer.
You're watching the 2020 Guardian Credit Union FCS kickoff on ESPN, presented by GEICO and Seth Rogen.
We've got Seth Rogen in the crowd. Jeremiah Oatfall kind of bears a striking resemblance to Zac Efron. Are we watching Neighbors or Austin Peay Central Arkansas right now?
I bet you anything that guy cannot stand Seth Rogen because he has chops like us, always telling that it looks like Seth Rogen.
First things first. By the way, this game last year entered the fourth quarter 13-10 the other way. Austin Peay was up 13-10 in the fourth quarter. Now Central Arkansas is up. Big third down and nine for Oatesball and the Governors as he avoids the pressure and eventually brought down there by Jalen Bedell in a big sack and a big play as Central Arkansas is able to hold the Governors offense.
Marquez Casey, number 93, doing a great job working back to the quarterback's level. You start rushing upfield, you see him moving forward, works down there, forces him into a bad situation.
I have no pooch punt here.
I think at this point we've seen they're not afraid to go for it in a spot like this, and they've been setting up that option, like you mentioned, all night. Give him that half rollout that mimics the pooch.
Little Timmy Zett say, scare money, don't make money. Fourth down and eight. Will the Governors use their quarterback as a punter, as they have, as the play clock goes down? Yeah, they're going to take a delay game, back this thing up, play field position. As Oatesball's been the punter throughout the evening, if you're just joining us, the normal long snapper for Austin Peay did not make the trip. Cameron Miller, linebacker, backup long snapper. First snap went over the punter's head. A snap hit the ground later, and then a snap went under the punter, Cole Deeds, later. So they said, you know what? Enough's enough. Let's pooch punt it. Let's play it safe.
A thing I did not expect to say, because your quarterback has done such a good job of placing punts, you can use him to play the field position game in this spot. Game one of college football already.
Tell you what,
interesting results.
We've even made history tonight. The first zero, number zero. I don't even know if that counts as a digit. There's the pooch punt. And again, inside the 10. I don't know that you could ask for anything better, even if you had a full-time punter and a long snapper. Let's take a look at tonight's Fighting Spirit moment, brought to you by Modelo. This was the first play of the college football season. It was C.J. Evans, 75 yards, the fifth longest by an Austin Peay player of the last 25 seasons. And then for Central Arkansas, Kier Crossley takes it in. Two touchdowns on the opening night, both running backs. And that's where we have a couple field goals mixed in. You've got a 13-10 ball game with an entire fourth quarter to play. Settling, I think this one's going to be fun to finish.
We came in talking about Tyler Hudson, Luan Winningham, Benico Harley, and the running back said, excuse me, we'd like a word.
Right. Game starts with us. And this possession starts with Crossley off the left side. Kier Crossley, big gain on first. Tackled by Terrell Vassell. And we saw this in their touchdown drive. Chunks out of Crossley, 37 yards.
Great job just sustaining on that backside by the left guard. You saw the tight end leading up on the linebacker, and everyone just getting enough, and the running back, great vision on that cutback.
And again, the tempo for the Bears. Little trick play back to Smith. Smith going deep. And misses Winningham. And he had him open.
We saw the trick play attempt for Austin Peay early on. Benico Harley, the former converted quarterback at wide receiver for Austin Peay. Braylon Smith on the double reverse pass. Got a little too excited on that
one.
Even
that looked a little bunched up though. The
tucked away in the reverse and the pitch back. And just get the sense, early season execution.
And a tight game in the fourth quarter.
Smith left side, back shoulder, great execution by LaJuan Winningham. Credit for the catch.
This is what we expected from the relationship between this experienced quarterback and his wide receivers here. Great timing on that one. They've developed over the course of the game. Another example of Braylon Smith using the snap count, identifying the blitzer, and knowing I've got a matchup I like on the backside of this play with LaJuan Winningham.
Good for 17 yards. Winningham, 4 catches, 63 yards, been targeted 12 times. So now the 38-yard line for the Bears. All right, so I'm not going to let Golic Jr. play the replay game, Eric. This is too easy. Too easy, because I think it's a catch. I'm not going to give you a freebie. We'll check the completion coming up after this.
Control.
Day trips are better than daydreams. Experience the thrill of a bigger world in a Lexus high-performance vehicle. Visit your local Lexus dealer in person or online for exceptional offers at the Golden Opportunity Sales Event. Experience amazing at your Lexus dealer.
Fairness to the officials. They didn't get any preseason camp work either, being due diligence with these catches. LaJuan Winningham, both feet in bounds for the Golic Jr. season tally on the replays. I was not going to honor that one.
I feel like you boxed me out going to break. I was going to give them credit on that one. That feels like at least half a point for me. I'm going to argue with Rob Adamski, our producer, after this.
Well, we don't do half points here. It's all or nothing with Matt Berry, Mike Golic Jr., Lauren Sisler. So happy to be a part of the 2020 kickoff of college football. First down and 10. Do the PPR stuff with the other Matthew Berry in fantasy football. Smith back to throw. Deep pass over the middle. Two defenders covering LaJuan Winningham. Let's go back out to Lauren Sisler.
Hey guys, you guys were talking about the officiating crew and obviously some of the challenges they're faced with the new protocols that are in place. I talked to one of the officials when he was coming back on the field at halftime, asked him and said, are you getting used to it yet? And he said the biggest thing obviously is the mask, pulling it up and down, being able to breathe. But then the whistle, you constantly have to find that whistle on your belt pack and being able to find that and kind of get used to that. As you know, these officials have their habits and they know exactly where to go. And in this case, they're having to change things up quite a bit.
An adjustment throughout the year is what we're going to see this season. Is Smith able to avoid the pressure? Ball comes out, and Smith able to fall back on it.
I can tell you from the extensive experience I had 2 years ago guest refereeing the South Carolina spring game that any bit of distraction you've got during the course of that game flow is going to take your eyes off some of those plays, especially by the sideline where you're trying to juggle a lot. As we heard before, these guys have been working on Zoom like everybody else. There hasn't been a lot of on-field time together.
The one thing we've heard in life and everybody's jobs, and it's an extension even here in college football, new normal. And that's what we're going to deal with all of 2020. But the fact that they're out here playing is a big third and 11. As Smith again has to step up to the pocket, and he's going to keep it himself, tackled by a host of Governor's defenders. It's going to bring up fourth down, led by the all-everything nickelback Cordell Jackson.
And I've loved this second half adjustment by Braylon Smith. You saw him take the green grass in front of him, live to play another down. They're staying on the field. He knows if I can get in range, my coach is going to reward me going forward on fourth down.
Tonight's story with both quarterbacks has been the misses on opportunities that they had.
We've seen both quarterbacks have some open receivers. They haven't been able to connect. They have made some big plays in their own right, but you know which way this game, either way it ends, they're going to look at this tape and see that they had opportunities to make a quick play, and they just didn't do it. So fourth and five, play clock goes to zero. Again, giving them a little more room to punt. Taking the delay of game penalty.
Maybe I've been playing too much Madden, looking at all these fourth downs. We got spoiled early in the game when both coaches seemed to be trading, almost daring the other to actually punt it on a fourth down.
You know what game I miss? EA Sports College Football.
It's in the game.
Hughes Ford to punt. Benico Harley set to return for the Governors. And Harley, fair catch. Is that at the 12-yard line? Can Jeremiah Oaksball lead the Governors to the lead of the fourth quarter? Got a flag on the play and a little extracurricular activity.
Referees sorting out the aftermath on what seemed like a routine fair catch.
There's nothing routine about 2020.
Truer words never spoken.
See if there's a little
unsportsmanlike conduct. Number 50 of the kicking team. Unsportsmanlike conduct. Number 41 of the receiving team. Their first unsportsmanlike conduct of the game. Those penalties offset. Media timeout.
All right, so J.W. Jones, one of the guilty parties on there, as we get a couple of unsportsmanlike conducts. Governor's offense coming up next.
Trips are better than daydreams. Experience the thrill of a bigger world in a Lexus high-performance vehicle. Visit your local Lexus dealer in person or online for exceptional offers at the Golden Opportunity Sales Event. Experience amazing at your Lexus dealer.
Absolutely incredible story of Austin Peay quarterback Jeremiah Oatesball, one of five siblings. He has one biological brother and then two siblings adopted from China, two other siblings adopted from Africa. His fiance, Maeve Kelly, in that picture, as you see the Oatesball clan in attendance in Montgomery, Alabama tonight. But he told us when we spoke with him, he said as a quarterback, you serve first. And he was taught that growing up. And he's a hard kid not to root for because of how gracious he is with everyone.
So grounded, so charismatic. And smart enough to remember to mention his fiance during the call we were on with him, too. He understood that happy wife, happy life early on.
We should mention that. He made it a point. Get my fiance in there for more. Let's go down to Lauren.
Yeah, he specifically said, Lauren, do not forget the fiance. I would be remiss if I forgot to mention the fiance. So certainly a great family story. And you talk about service. Oatesball is a tremendous team leader, uses service to really set the tone for his teammates. Strong in his faith, he took seven of his teammates on a missions trip to Africa, as you mentioned earlier. Through his service, he tries to teach guys that life is bigger than football and hopes that they can all draw lessons for the way he leads the team on and off the field.
Quick hitter there to mentor. Again, if you just joined us, you want more on the Jeremiah Oatesball story. He was the Ohio Valley Freshman Player of the Year, got hurt in the eighth play of the second game against Central Arkansas last year, had to battle his way back out onto the field, and he's a player of why I love college football. Probably does not have NFL aspirations, but you know, whatever he does in life, he's going to be successful. But first things first, he gets to throw on a uniform every Saturday and play with his team. Now second and six for Oates Fall. A quick look there to Pollard and a great open field tackle by number 25, Chris Kirschner.
Incredible job there, because Oates Fall saw the blitz. He replaced and threw exactly where he saw the pressure coming from. And just a great job by Kirschner getting him down in that spot, forcing third and six here now, where Oates Fall and company have really struggled tonight. So let's see, can they get the ball back into Bonico Harley? Haven't heard from him in a while.
And they struggled at this spot last year, just one win in one possession games going into the fourth quarter. You know they want to change that in their albeit limited season in 2020. Third and six for Oates Fall. Quick hitter dropped and incomplete by Vincent Taylor. Looks as if he was ready to run before he had a grip on the ball.
Had the screen set up to another single digit. The zero on the field on the offensive side in Vincent Taylor. Again, the first time in college football history we get that. Would have liked to have seen the offensive zero get in on the action there, as they are now 2 for 13 on the night on third down.
They scored a touchdown on their opening offensive play, 75 yards, and nothing since. Fourth and six. Again, Oates Fall has acted as the punter. And that really the first one we've seen him shank off his foot. Ends up taking a little bit of an Austin Peay bounce. Going to settle right there at midfield, so it's going to be great field position for Central Arkansas. They've got the 13-10 lead as we are under 9 minutes in the fourth quarter.
Control.
Day trips are better than daydreams. Experience the thrill of a bigger world in a Lexus high-performance vehicle. Visit your local Lexus dealer in person or online for exceptional offers at the Golden Opportunity Sales Event. Experience amazing at your Lexus dealer.
Nobody likes an awkward silence. You can actually use it for something good.
You haven't really been yourself lately. Are you okay?
Find out how you can help a friend with their mental health at seizetheawkward.org.
The Guardian Credit Union FCS Kickoff is presented on ESPN by GEICO. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. And in part by Montgomery County, Alabama. Come for the history, stay for the future.
Last three of these FCS kickoff games played at the Crampton Bowl here in Montgomery, Alabama. Rule number one, you got you some lemon ice, pull down the mask.
Pull down the mask and have at it, young man. I salute you.
Hand off up the middle to Cameron Myers. Myers 11 carries, 66 yards on the night. That for three to put him to 69 yards. And you wonder what type of play calling now we're going to see. And a Central Arkansas three-point lead, able to run the ball well tonight with both running backs, 171 yards.
Nice output there. Got to be able to take some shots downfield now. It's been conservative for both teams.
There's a quick play fake and a quick completion. Helmet comes off. Jared Barnes, the receiver, and easy flags there for the official. Throw Vassell on the tackle.
And we've seen, Matt, it's short, it's runs, it's working right now, but eventually it's going to take someone going back downfield. That's how this game was won. Shoe on the other foot for Central Arkansas last year.
Fast. No, none of the defense. 15 penalty. And first down. in the game.
Easy call there, the elbow at the end for good measure.
And no drama there. Vassell yanked it off, so tack on 15 yards. So a real opportunity here now for the Bears.
Down on the edge of the red zone, this is primetime Luan Winningham space if you can get him singled up.
Winningham, four catches, 64 yards. It's been quiet for the star receiver. Smith, quick pitch out. Cameron Myers makes a man miss. Tackled by Troy Henderson. Gain of seven.
Give Winningham a lot of credit working on the edge as a blocker on that one. You hear all the time in offensive meetings, we can have good runs if the offensive line fits it up, the quarterback and running back do their job. We'll break big ones if the wide receivers is Winningham wide open and uncovered. Quickly realizing the error of their ways.
Second and three, Smith gonna throw again. He's pressured, able to sneak out of it. He's just gonna throw that away. Play smart football. Pressured on the play by Matthew Gale.
Third and three now, you'd expect them to keep it on the ground here. Understand that if you can just get a couple of yards, you're either dealing with a fourth and short with a big quarterback or just pick it up altogether right here. They've been blocking it up well in the second half up front on these runs.
You know their head coach, Nathan Brown, and play caller, Ken Collins. They don't want a field goal. They want six to extend this lead to two possessions. Smith over the middle, caught and then dropped by Tyler Hudson. Defended on the play by Henderson.
Six-man pressure up front. The group does a great job picking it up. That's a clean pocket, but even better coverage downfield right there. Isaiah Norman stuck like glue to Tyler Hudson. That's just a better defensive play after the offense gives you a chance up front.
So Hayden Ray back on to kick. 2 for 2 in his field goal attempts tonight, 32-yarder. Kick is up and true to extend Central Arkansas lead to 16-10. So Austin Peay still a touchdown out. Can they make something happen? We'll find out next here on ESPN.
Control.
Day trips are better than daydreams. Experience the thrill of a bigger world in a Lexus high-performance vehicle. Visit your local Lexus dealer in person or online for exceptional offers at the Golden Opportunity Sales Event. Experience amazing at your Lexus dealer.
Up next, Sports Center with Michael Eaves and Kenny Mayne. They'll have the meaning of an unprecedented college football season, plus the NBA returns. Players speak on the impact of the boycott, how the Bucks and Lakers responded with a chance to clinch their series at Sports Center right here on ESPN and on the ESPN app. Central Arkansas extends their lead 16-10. Saren Hughes Ford get a kick for the Bears. Benico Harley deep to receive. 2,000 fans here tonight to watch the opening game of college football season. Crampton Bowl, Montgomery, Alabama. They can let that ball go deep into the end zone. Touchback ball starts 25-yard line for Oatesville and the Austin Peay offense. Mike Golic Jr., Matt Barry, Lawrence Sisler alongside. 2020's college football season is finally here. You're looking at two FCS powers ranked 11th and 13th, respectively, Austin Peay and Central Arkansas. Neutral site game down in Montgomery, Alabama, as we finally get to enjoy our Saturdays with a little bit of college football.
16-10, Central Arkansas. Brian Snead in the backfield for Oatfall on the offense. Play fake, Oatfall off his back foot, causing complete, intended for Harley.
Everything with Oatfall looks off right now, timing-wise, as we've got a player down up front.
To be Elijah Brown, the injured player.
And again, depth up front on both lines, certainly an area that you look at this season because of the limitations, the conditioning. We've heard coaches talk about potentially having more guys ready to roll through at that position, that depth getting tested early here.
Gavin Campbell in to replace him at right tackle. Oates ball to give to Snead. Snead's been quiet of late. And a physical run for the Ohio State transfer. Gain of 8.
Great job just settling down here, going back to the run. Just because of the way Oates Falls looked tonight, only 11 of 22 on the night, just has never looked comfortable. And I don't know if it's that foot maybe after the slip bothering him, his base underneath. That was such a big focus for his offseason, changing up his stance in the shotgun, working on having his feet underneath. They love studying Drew Brees in that quarter room for that reason.
130 rushing yards for the Governors. Again, the handoff to the left side to Snead on 3rd and 2. He's going to come up short. No gain. 6:50 left in the game. Full complement to timeouts. Defense is playing pretty well. Too early for a decision on 4th down?
Yeah, I think just based on field position here, it's too early. You got to count on your defense and give them better field position. Remember, they were coming off a shank for that last scoring drive.
And again, Oatfall has been punting tonight because of some long snapper issues. Play clock down to 5. And he's going to do that punt again. And save for the last one, we saw him shank to the right. It's worked pretty well. He didn't come into this game, I bet, thinking he was going to punt. The only problem for Oatfall is his punts are right near his completions. 42-yarder on that one. And you talked about it a minute ago, close games with Austin Peay and Central Arkansas. One of them came through, one of them did not. Games decided by one possession. See Austin Peay 2-3, Central Arkansas 5-0, and they had a remarkable season last year. Did Central Arkansas, both these teams, making it to the FCS playoffs?
Central Arkansas, if they get it down around that 4-minute mark where you can get into that grind out offense, has some of those pro personnel sets in there, that ground and pound running game that they can try and finish this out with.
Crossley, a big night. 109 yards rushing for the Bears running back, and that's what they give it to on 1st down off the left side. Tackled and met immediately by Jack McDonald.
And you said it, understanding the clock in this game, the way the Austin Peay offense is operating, you can still have shots built in there if you're Central Arkansas, but much like you came out the opening drive of the second half, you'd like to lean on Crossley and the others to try and give you some easy time to eat up clock, and even if it ultimately ends in a punt, flip field position again.
Pulls it out of Crossley. And a quick completion, not much going for number 41, Joshua Nix. First time we've called Nix's name tonight. Tackled by Cam Ruffin.
But sometimes it's just that. The conservative first and second down play calling has led to 2 of 14 on 3rd down for Austin Peay, 3 of 14 on 3rd down for Central Arkansas. When you're majoring in 3rd and 7+, and you don't have your full complement now, we haven't seen them confident enough going downfield. This is likely another screen draw situation.
It is must stop time now for Austin Peay. Down 6.
Got to snap the ball if you're the center there with the guy in the neutral zone. Get yourself an easy 5 yards.
Smith up in the pocket and a quick dump. Second play in a row. He hits Nix, and that's going to be a 4th down stop for Austin Peay, forcing Central Arkansas to punt now as we approach the 4-minute mark. They're down 6. Good effort by the Governor's defense there as we have an injured player for Austin Peay. Number 52, Mason Harwell, the injured player. Get a reminder coming up after us. SportsCenter, Kenny Mayne, Michael Leaves will walk you through the day in sports, Major League Baseball. I expect an extensive highlight of this game. In fact, if three of the top 10 plays don't come from this game.
We've had one-handed grabs, 75-yard touchdown runs. This game, again, we expected there to be some things to work on, some rust to knock off, but there have been big-time plays made in this
game. It's the only show in town.
Yeah. Absolutely.
I expect top 10 respect tonight. How about that for total yards? In the first half, 162. Second half, 216-77. Not balanced either way. This has been all about the Bears as Harwell goes off the field under his own power.
And now a chance, and this has been the advantage, really one of them all night for Central Arkansas, having their normal punt unit available to them. You pin them back here, and until Jeremiah Oathfall shows you that he is comfortable throwing the football in a way that he has not displayed, especially in this second half, you apply pressure, you pin him back, and you let your defense go to work.
Man, don't you love this? Here we are, first Saturday of college football, and it's down to one score, late fourth quarter. Hughes Ford on to punt. Jay Parker on to receive. Who's going to make a big play for their team in the season opener? That punt goes out of bounds. And these teams have played in close games before. As we flash back to last year, early fourth quarter, Central Arkansas takes the lead. Braylon Smith to LaJuan Whittingham. Hadn't seen that tonight, but it worked last year. Minute 46 left. Smith, second TD pass to Whittingham to extend the lead. Then the ensuing Austin Peay drive. Robert Rochelle picks off Javon Craig, who came in for the injured Oathfall. And Central Arkansas would get the win 24-16 to Austin Peay. Have a little fourth quarter revenge, and we're about to find out.
And a reminder that Javon Craig is now on the coaching staff. He's a graduate assistant here.
Right.
And Tim Zetz, their offensive coordinator, said he's almost like a translator. Him and Jeremiah Oathfall take the coaching and interpret it for themselves in a way that's paid off huge for them.
See if Oathfall has some fourth quarter magic on it. Goes deep on first down. Has a receiver caught. Jay Parker, big play. Move the chains. Here come the Governors.
Ask and you shall receive, stepping up and getting a ball. And Jay Parker, there are plenty of bodies in the vicinity. 5-5 and quicks for days. Maybe a Mel Kiper, or I should say, Mike Mayockism, quicker than fast, but that time plenty quick enough to get behind the defense.
It was a matter of time before we saw Oathfall make a big play. That'll certainly get your drive going. 23 yards for a first down. Now inside the 20, Brian Snead in the backfield. Oathfall again, a quick throw, and again up top as the receiver and DB climb all over each other. That intended for Eugene Mintz at the tight end. What a perfectly placed throw to Parker.
And great concentration. We mentioned three bodies around him, defender on his back, and Parker with a little something extra coming off that. We hadn't heard his name much. We had seen him get the ball in short area. He's their gadget guy. And a normal day for them, if they've got D'Angelo Wilson here, you're moving him around. You're jet motioning them across the field, but they're going deep, making a big play.
Jay Parker, 5'5", 149 pounds. But boy, does he have that juice. Third pass in a row for Oathfall, and that one short of his receiver, intended for Panico Harley. Inside the 20, surprised they haven't tried to run either Evans or Snead up there.
And you just see the ball dying on Oathfall right now. He's shaking out his arm. You don't know if the shoulder's sore there. Not really stepping into the throw on that last one either. Again, they focus so much on the feet. They mentioned Drew Brees. They love his wide base, studying that in the quarterback room. Having that weight on the instep of your feet so you can drive forward, drive through on a throw like that instead of putting yourself in a third and long again.
Big third down. Oathfall that time hands it off to Snead. Snead has a block off the left side, had room to run, closed quick, tackled on the play by Cameron Godfrey. And another first game head coaching decision from Marcus Lovins here, 4th and 4, down 6.
You've made your living in that full house backfield, giving your quarterback that option look, plenty of passes off it. I'm loading that up and making them think about it here. Jeremiah Oakes' ball. Win with the one that brought you here. He's the guy you expected to make big plays for you today. Put the ball in his hands or in Brian Snead, a big back.
Oates fall on the field. Snead in the backfield. 4th and 4 for the Governors. Oates fall to pass. Up top. Incomplete. Flag on the play. Pollard had it fall into his chest. Defended by Stephen Mackey. And that is going to give Austin Peay a 1st and goal.
An absolute backbreaker. Can't say I'm a fan of the call. A little too close to goal line fade territory for me, which is a no-no, but a
pass interference. Number. First down.
Yeah, that.
And you would have expected, again, D'Angelo Wilson not making the trip tonight, that Benico Harley would have been the beneficiary. But it's been Jordan Pollard the entire night getting the targets going his way. And now, hand it off to your big back and let him plow his way into the end zone.
Let Snead eat. The Ohio State transfers run the ball hard tonight. 12 rushes, 43 yards, and I'm with you. If there's other offensive coordinators watching tonight, if you don't have Larry Fitzgerald, get rid of the goal line fade. It should be, just get rid of it. The lend around to Parker. Parker trying to weasel his way up in there. Finds himself at the one when you're 5'5", 149 pounds. You can hide.
You can hide. He's got the quicks, but lateral runs around the goal line like that, to me, are overthinking things in this area of the field. Think about the level of coordination that takes. The last thing you want is to slip up on a handoff, slip up on the pitch underneath. A downhill run here, pull one of your big-bodied guard that's been working for you tonight and hammer this thing in.
So here we go. 2nd and goal. Austin Peay down 6. They've had a successful running game to this point of the night. Can they complete the comeback now under 2 minutes? Play clock down to 0. And Oates ball fired up, but able to get the timeout called before a costly delay of game penalty. Have a look at the clock, Golden Jr.
Oh, there's no, that should be a penalty.
In fairness, we can't see what's going on the sideline. If a coach was running up and trying to bang the timeout.
Unless that did come from Marcus Lovings on the sideline, they're in a bit of trouble here and could be backed up in a pivotal situation. And that's even forgetting, Matt, that should they get in the end zone at this point, we've still got to worry about the snapping situation on the extra point.
And that's a great, great point. We've seen it throughout the night. Their backup long snapper, Cameron Miller, linebackers had issues. That's why Oatesball has been punting. Marcus Lovins, his 1st game, head coach of Austin Peay. He was interim, given the interim role in July 7 when Mark Hudspeth resigned earlier this summer for family reasons. So this a new game for Lovins as well, coaching his ball club for the first time, and right now is a 3-game season for the Governors in what has been just an unprecedented offseason in the greatest sport on the planet. Here we have a game going down in the final 2 minutes, and that is Snead up the middle, and he is stopped by a host of Bears defenders led by Big J.W. Jones. Now 3rd and goal.
Ajavius Brown making waves in the middle. It is ugly. It is 4-point stances, submarining down to the goal line. But if you're a defensive tackle in the middle of the fray there and you can get penetration, you disrupt everything for an offense. And allow a guy like J.W. Jones, great night, 8 tackles, has been active all over the field.
Brian Snead, the bigger of the two running backs, the transfer from Ohio State, dismissed from the Buckeyes, 5-star recruit early on in his career in Columbus. He went to a junior college, now found his way to Austin Peay for this season. C.J. Evans, also a running back for Austin Peay, 10 carries, 99 rushing yards. But when you look at this game as a whole, as we are now at a minute 44 left, sloppy opening season play out of the quarterbacks, Braylon Smith and Oates Bowl. Early fireworks, but a lot of what we expected. End result, Mike Golic Jr., it's close in the fourth quarter.
Close in the fourth quarter, and we saw a big play to Jay Parker. Big plays in the passing game have set this up, but being able to close it with the run game down this close.
So third and goal. You would expect to ride Snead twice. Oates Bowl, the keeper, Oates Bowl dives across the end zone and ties the game for Austin Peay. The quarterback who's been through so much, lost for the season in this very game, week two last year, just put his team on, or tied the game for his team with a minute 40 left.
We figured that keeper was waiting somewhere in there. It'd been a while since we'd seen him get a design carry.
Snap paramount. Kick is up, snap is good, kick is good. And now the Governors have taken a 17-16 lead. Perhaps the biggest snap of that young man's career, the backup center. The fake to Snead, and Oates Bowl, great read.
And you see Eugene Minner, the tight end, who's been active all night, getting just enough coming across. It doesn't have to be pretty, but gets just enough of number 18, Malik Wilson.
And how about the Oates Bowl family? They love it. Fiance and siblings made the trip here to Montgomery, Alabama. Coach Marcus Love, it's his first game as the interim head coach of the Austin Peay Governors. And Jeremiah Oates Bowl has put his team on top with a minute 40 left in our 2020 kickoff game here on ESPN. It hadn't been the greatest night for the quarterback, but when he needed to step up for his team, when it was his time in the fourth quarter, he did.
Big throw downfield to set up the red zone opportunity and then calls his own number to drive it home. This is the type of leader you want to build your foundation on as a team. This is why Marcus Lovins and company are more than comfortable going into battle with Jeremiah Oates Bowl.
So Grant Paulette set to kick. Christian Richmond and Dwight Blakey deep to receive. Central Arkansas and their star quarterback, Braylon Smith, two timeouts. Down one. And that's going to be Richmond on the reception. He's going to get met in the middle of the field. Good coverage by the Governor's special teams. Tackled by Terrell Vassell.
Matt, this is a situation you drill in training camp all the time. Minute 34 left, two timeouts at your disposal here. You've got to have some pace about you here, understanding you can stop the clock a couple of times here. Those same throws that you've been successful on all night if you're Braylon Smith, getting the ball out of your hands quick, letting your great receivers like Barnes, Hudson get run after the catch opportunities, all in play.
You hear the crowd. It is a small crowd. Each school got 400 tickets each. Sold the rest online to make the 2,000 crowd happen tonight. And they are witnessing a last possession game, flag on the play. Is Braylon Smith able to connect with Whittingham? Isn't this great?
All you could ask for, and a mirror image again of last year with Austin Peay on the other side now, the go-ahead touchdown late, seeing if Central Arkansas can respond.
I mean, you didn't know. We'll wait for the call here. So offsides on the defense, it'll give Central Arkansas 5 yards. So we didn't know if we were going to play this year.
And you see right over the left tackle, the defensive end, crowded in that neutral zone. That's the fatigue mounting up now. We talked so much about conditioning, attention to detail late in the game. We've seen it happen in the biggest stages. I think 2 years ago in the playoffs for the Chiefs, the difference in the game with D Ford lining up in the neutral zone.
First and five now after the 5 yard penalty. Minute 28 left, two timeouts for the Bears. Smith escapes the pocket. Quick give to Kier. Crossley, who's had a big night. Crossley able to shake a couple of defenders and get out of bounds. That'll move the change for Central Arkansas.
And just a great individual effort by Crossley here. See the D-line runs the twist up front, flushes Braylon a bit, but then in the open field, the ability to make Troy Henderson miss by Crossley. And get out of bounds to stop the clock.
Heads-y play out of Crossley there to get out of bounds to preserve the two timeouts. So a first down for Central Arkansas. And again, it's Smith. Again, he's pressured. And a great catch out of Hudson. Smith keeping the play alive with his feet, able to find Hudson. Again, moving the chains for Central Arkansas.
The catch 17 yards on these Central Arkansas receivers. Going low, making it look easy. If the ball's a little low and behind you, so what? You understand you're there to make up at times for a minor error in your quarterback's accuracy.
In Austin Peay territory. Smith has found his rhythm on his drive and again finds his receiver Winningham. Down to a minute left in the opening game of the 2020 season. Now under a minute, gain of six. Looking for Crossley out of the backfield. Crossley wasn't ready for it.
A merciful incompletion there for an offensive group that looks gassed right now. You see guys struggling to get up to the line, making sure they're lined up before the plays. The attrition setting in here. Now a chance, catch your breath, third and manageable. You've still got both timeouts at your disposal. You're in good shape right now if you're Central Arkansas.
Plenty of time, plenty of timeouts. Call the offense if you're Central Arkansas. Nathan Brown and Ken Collins and Braylon Smith. Play clock down to five. Pressure comes. Smith looks left, throws left. Up top, what a catch by Tyler Hudson.
Thread the needle. Nathan Page is going to hear this whiz over his right shoulder. Directly into the waiting arms of Tyler Hudson. Unbelievable concentration with all of that fatigue we mentioned.
So first and goal now for Central Arkansas. I think Nathan Brown's going to be happy to bang a timeout there. Gather it, because you've got now first and goal. One timeout left. 40 seconds left in the ballgame. You are in field goal position.
You're ready to go. You're ready to take control, and it's because you've got a quarterback that's been calm in this moment. You see the heated exchange here, but it's because of the calm, cool, and collected nature of the way Braylon Smith's approached it. You've seen taking the time up to snaps for his receivers to get to the line, get set in these situations, understanding the pace of the offense needed for this to work.
5 of 6, 68 yards for the veteran star quarterback. Again, coming off a record-setting year in this game last year, 283 yards, 3 touchdowns, and this is the storyline you wanted to tell. Oatesfall, the star quarterback for Austin Peay, leads his team to a game-leading touchdown, and now it's Smith's turn. He's got the ball, first and goal, one timeout left, 40 seconds down one.
What does Coach tell us? Everyone's got a panic button. He's never seen his quarterback hit that. That demeanor right now gives them a chance.
Smith gonna go to the end zone. Smith has Winningham. Touchdown, Bears. We've waited for the star receiver to make a play, and he made the biggest one of the night. 10-yard touchdown from his quarterback, Braylon Smith.
They found the matchup they liked on that drive, because remember, Nathan Page saw that ball whiz over his head that Tyler Hudson caught earlier to set that up. And that time they see 5-on-12, and LaJuan Winningham goes out and gets just that. A great win in that situation and an easy throw and catch over the top.
You can use any adjective you want to describe a quarterback. We saw every single one out of Braylon Smith on that drive. Poise, leadership, took his team down when they needed it most, and he found his star receiver, who's been quiet, but he knew he could rely on him.
They're going to take a look at this one again because he goes to the ground, make sure he maintains control at the end of this catch. You see the separation there. Veteran with a little push off, gets the feet down, goes down. And I see control all the way, hands underneath the ball, even if it moves, as long as he's got it clamped.
So because of the magnitude of the moment, I'm going to count this as the Mike Golic docket. One sideline, happy, smiling, Oates fall. Grab his lid, he's got time. 34 seconds, two timeouts. But what an amazing finish for both of these quarterbacks late in the fourth quarter with one possession left and a big extra point coming. Hayden Ray, the kicker, Will Seilers, the holder.
They're back out going for two in this spot. They want to make this an even touchdown game, go up seven.
So they will attempt the two-point conversion. Braylon Smith rolls out, and it's good. Sam Camargo, the two-point conversion, and now Austin Peay has to score a touchdown. Do we dare say overtime to start the 2020 college football season? But what a drive it was for Braylon Smith coming into the game. We knew he was the leader of the offense. Mike Golic Jr., we saw every bit of it on that drive.
Crossley here with the great individual effort, and then the heads-up play to get out of bounds. We remember the neutral zone infraction that kick-started the party, and then Tyler Hudson kicked in the door. An unbelievable catch over that back shoulder. And then Lawan Winningham, a familiar name and a familiar situation there. The back corner of the end zone, and a great touch pass on the two-point conversion by your quarterback to Sam Camargo to put them up seven.
It's about your leaders when the games are close. This player, Braylon Smith, the leadership he's done on and off the field with everything going on in the country. Nathan Brown has said, this is the guy that I want to be our leader. And it's just been fun to watch him battle through. It's been adverse. It's been a lot of adversity for both these teams tonight. But when they needed him, they got him.
And what a great building block to go into the rest of the season with.
Saren Hughes for the kick. And that's going to go back into the end zone for a touchback. So to set the scene here, two timeouts left for Osbolt. Austin Peay down seven. Osbolt led the team down for a touchdown the last timeout. Field goal not good enough.
And we know the names you're looking for. Jay Parker was your big play opportunity before, but Jordan Pollard's been your consistent source of offense in the passing game for Jeremiah Osbolt. Expect an early dosage of him, but a shot's gonna have to come. And I'm dialing up Jay Parker again if I can. Speed to burn on that play. We show and saw the propensity for a big play on the last touchdown drive.
75 yards away. Again, if you didn't hear, D'Angelo Wilson, their star receiver, did not make the bus trip to Montgomery, Alabama. So it's been Benico Harley, the other star, and a collection of role players, and Jay Parker, Jordan Pollard, and whistle early.
Delay a game on the defense for late substitution. Fourth the play clock to run out. 5-yard penalty, still down.
Remember, it was a defensive penalty that got the last drive going for Central Arkansas, the neutral zone infraction by Austin Peay. You don't want to give them anything, not with a quarterback that just showed you he's capable of going the distance.
So now 70 yards the distance for Jeremiah Oates-Fall. Again, two timeouts. Nathan Brown trying to figure that one out. Ball rolls to his right to escape pressure, throws it downfield, nearly intercepted by Nick Nakwasa. Nakwasa could have ended the game.
Throwing back across your body to the middle of the field, that is a day one no-no for the quarterback. But Nakwasa is not going to find an easier interception to ice the game than that one. I have a feeling the wide receivers and the team are going to let him hear about that in the Monday meeting, provided this all goes well for Central Arkansas to finish it out.
Yeah, that is ill-advised for a quarterback 365 days a year, live to play another down. Oats fall over the middle. It is caught immediately by Eugene Minter. Big play, first down will stop the clock.
Now you got to get up to the line and get it off, or you've got your two timeouts still.
They'll clock the ball as the clock will start once the down resets. Minter been targeted quite a bit tonight by his quarterback. 8 targets, 4 catches, 35 yards. In Central Arkansas territory. Oates ball to the sideline. Dropped by Benico Harley.
An absolute backbreaker at a moment like this for a guy who is a consistent performer on your team. And outside of D'Angelo Wilson is the other impact name we would have brought up on this offense. You're going to need every bit right now, especially as you have to paint towards the sideline now with just 13 seconds left.
Play set up perfectly, gets out of bounds. You're not wasting the timeout. It moves the chains. Now third and 10 from the 46-yard line. Oates ball. Again over the middle. That pass tipped, and it falls incomplete. Again intended for Minter.
Nakwasu again doing a good job, hand on the back there, being discreet about it there, disrupting the route enough at the top. And now it's 4th and 10, 8 seconds left with the game on the line. You're trying to get your quarterback outside the pocket, give him a look at the end zone here, or up underneath, knowing you've got a timeout to maybe get it down.
Yeah, they're going to use one of their timeouts. Marcus Lovins wants to think this over. Game on the line for Austin Peay. Governor's scheduled to play 3 games this year. Ohio Valley Conference said they weren't going to play their season, move it to the spring. Central Arkansas, the opener. They are at Pitt September 12th, at Cincinnati September 19th. On the other side of it, Central Arkansas, they've got the most games of any FCS program. They've scheduled 9. You come to Nathan Brown and want to play on a Saturday, he'll say yes.
He gave all the credit in the world to Dr. Teague, their athletic director, for going out and finding these games, knowing he wasn't going to turn down work. This is a team that's ready to go, that's got 3 FBS wins since they moved to the Division I level, and now going to get a chance at 3 overall this season.
Any game this year, you just get the sense, means so much for what both of these programs and programs across the country are dealing with throughout this COVID 19 pandemic. All right, 4th and 10, Mike Golick Jr., what are we doing?
You're asking everyone up front to hold up. If you're one of the offensive linemen, you understand you're going to get a 3-man rush. You want to create double teams here with whatever backs in pressure for you guys. Get your quarterback out towards his throwing hand and get this ball going towards the end zone.
This is the game for Austin Peay. Designed run for Jeremiah Oatsball. What a play call by Tim Zett. Now that gives you an opportunity. 2 seconds left. Chuck one in the end zone. You have a look now.
And a great job by your quarterback understanding the timing necessary for all that. Now, all of the same things I just described are absolutely in play with this situation. It's end zone or bust. We know that. And it's going to happen through the air as much as you were able to pick up there. Now just outside of the red zone.
So they'll use their final timeout. Headsy play by the quarterback. You have 2 seconds to make a mistake. He gets out of bounds. Ball on a good position to give them a look. 27-yard line. That's got Benico Harley or Eugene Minter written all over it.
The way the night's gone, I wouldn't rule out Pollard in this situation either. He seemed to be the one getting all of those missing targets.
6'3", 186. Benico 6'1", 195. Eugene Minter, the big tight end, 6'4", 225.
all capable of making contested catches. We saw it from Minter on this drive. We've seen it from Pollard earlier in the game.
What if I told you the 2020 season of college football came down to one final play for a chance to tie it and send it to overtime? Oates ball. He's going to throw it, going to come up short. It's going to be intercepted by Central Arkansas, and that will do it. The Central Arkansas Bears have beaten Austin Peay 24-17 in a remarkable kickoff to a remarkable sport. Mike Golic Jr., your final thoughts on what we saw in what's been an unprecedented offseason.
An incredible effort. We know it wasn't going to be perfect out of the gate, but you saw through all the attrition, through all of the tiredness at the end of this game, these players fight to make big plays when it matters.
Congratulations to Nathan Brown in Central Arkansas. For Lauren Sisler and Mike Golic Jr., you see tempers flaring on the field, but all we can say is this. I'm Matt Barry. And we have college football back 24-17 as you see the skirmish. Looks as if tempers flared there for a moment.
You wait all offseason, you hit each other all training camp, you finally got a chance to go out there and put it on display. You see it spill over here, you see cooler heads likely prevailing now as they understand the win is in for everybody who got to be a part of this game already tonight.
And in this age of social distancing and all the COVID-19 protocols, it is important to get both teams to the locker room and just an appreciation of being able to kick off the season when for so long it did not look as if it was going to happen. All right, so now I get to reset my dramatic toss-off of the first college football game of the season. For Lauren Sisler, Mike Golic Jr., I'm Matt Barry. Let's hope this was the beginning of a successful season. Central Arkansas wins 24-17. Now to SportsCenter.